Plus 2 is proud to bring you the 2 Plus 2 Pokercast, presented by the Pokerstars VIP Club.
This week on the Pokercast, Brandon Shak Harris joins us and all your WSOP news and more. Now, here they are. Looking to get 180-1, they can min cash 3 times at this year's World Series. Adam and Terrence.
Welcome everybody to the 2 Plus 2 Pokercast, presented by the PokerStars VIP Club. I am your host, Dave Schwartz, alongside Roscoe P. Coltrane. And Mr. Terrence Chan down in Las Vegas. T, how are you, sir?
I'm doing well. It's actually kind of cooled down a little bit in Vegas. It's pleasantly tolerable.
It's like 38?
Yeah, it's something like that. It's about, 33 right now, or for our American listeners, that comes up to something like only 90. Double digits.
Cool 90.
Yeah, exactly. I'm putting on the parka.
Not bad. How's your week down there in the World Series? Of course, we're right in the middle of the World Series, 47th annual World Series of Poker. We're in the, what do you call it, the heart of the World Series right now? We're
week two. I mean, I feel like this is the kind, like, people are settled in. They've played a few events. A few people have hit some scores. But, everybody's still sort of got the, well, there's lots more to go. I certainly feel that way. As to how things are going, I've bricked everything so far, which is, it's only been around 7 events, and I've bricked them pretty quickly. Let's see, since last time, what have I played since last time? I fired 1 bullet in the Millionaire Maker. I registered, ran up my chips a bunch, to about maybe 30,000 or so, and then promptly busted that off. So had a nice little eventful run in the Millionaire Maker. Hopped right directly into the 1500 8 game mix, which definitely was one I was looking forward to. But I pretty much bought in the last level that I possibly could. And day one structures are really fast this year, so I think I started off by playing, I want to say, 300 600 with 7500 chips. Or 100, 200, no limit hold'em with a 25 ante or 100, 200 PLO. So I didn't last long in that. Unfortunately, my name is not Jason Mercier. I don't get to just late reg everything and basically effectively become like the chip leader within half an hour of registering, even though everybody else is playing for like 5 hours.
Kid is on a roll.
Yeah, I mean, he's doing it again right now. I think last time I checked, he was crushing in the 10K horse, which was like immediately off his second place finish. I know we'll talk about that stuff, but yeah, I mean, he's having the kind of series a lot of people dream about. And since then, let's see, I played the 6 max no limit hold'em. And that was one I was obviously really looking forward to because, 6 max no limit hold'em is basically the only fun no limit hold'em these days. I saw a tweet from Daniel Negreanu, that he was playing his first no limit event, which was that one. And he was wearing the don't be a clock sucker t-shirt.
Nice.
Referring to the dramatic tanking that occurs in no limit hold'em tournaments. We definitely had some of that. I ran up some chips in this one too, but unfortunately couldn't run good long enough to hang around and make the money in that one. But I did hang around long enough, just basically 10 minutes too long, because I missed the 1500 limit hold'em.
Oh no, your event.
This was a pretty high value event for me. I might have a small edge over the field in the 1500 limit hold'ems. That's been my week in review. So 0-4 this, 0-3 last time I talked to you, 0-4 this week, but 10K limit hold'em on Friday.
That's what I was about to say.
And I'm also planning on dressing up as a senior and entering that event as well.
Do the Phil Lack. Remember when Phil showed up in full movie makeup, looking like an old guy with a hat on? Nobody knew it was him. Yeah, that's you could do that for this. No, you couldn't, right? Because your card will say your birth date.
Yeah,
you're
not
going to be able to do it.
Yeah, even if you can't. There's no way to game your way into that one. You can't even like pay extra money like with the ladies event. The ladies event, 1,000 buy-in for women and 10,000 for men. The seniors, because I guess it's a Nevada law thing. Nevada, you're allowed to actually discriminate based on age, but you're not allowed to discriminate based on gender for this kind of thing, which is why they have the weird rules for the ladies event, but not for the seniors event.
Pokercast 414 tonight. This is June 16th. 2016. Tonight we're on the show. We got a bunch of World Series stuff. We're going to get into some of the issues and the results that happened this week since we talked last. And we're also going to be joined by either Brandon Shak Harris or Matt Grapenthien. They're both playing in
whichever bus first.
Well, I think we might get one on a break at 9:15. We'll see which one we can get a hold of, and or if they bust, like as you said there. And we're going to talk to them. Matt obviously having a great series so far, second in the stud, the 10K stud championship. Two other caches, deep runs, and 212s, I believe. In
212s, both in Raz.
In Raz,
so
barrels.
So if you play stud for high, he finished second. If you play stud for low, he finishes 12th.
Right. And having a great series. Brandon, Shak Harris, of course, 2 years ago went on that amazing run. Came second to George Danzer in the World Series Poker Player of the Year leaderboard, and Bracelet, and had an amazing year. Cash game player. When we were down in L.A. this year, we at the GPI Awards, we wandered into the Commerce, and he was sitting in the big mix game at the Commerce. So had some questions ready for him to hear how that's going for him. Down in Los Angeles, of course, moved out from Chicago a couple of years back. So, but that's the plan. We got Ross report, some emails, a voicemail or two in the last segment. So why don't we get right to some in case you missed it.
How did he miss the open goal? 6-4, and he comes up zero.
Oh, no! Oh, yes! He missed it!
He's missed it! How on earth did he miss that?
When we left off last week, we were talking about event number 7 was complete. Event 8 was my brother was going on a deep run there in event 8. The $1,500 horse event ended up busting out somewhere in the money. But American Ian Johns wins his second bracelet in $212,000. He was his second bracelet a decade after he won his first one. But the amazing story.
Did he win a limit hold'em bracelet? I feel like
he did. John, you're right.
Yes.
Yeah,
okay,
absolutely right.
So I actually feel like I was watching him play heads. I'm stalling for time right now because I'm pretty sure
watching
Ian Johns play for heads up for his first bracelet, and I'm right because second place finisher with Jared Ankenman, of course, co-author of The Math of Poker, former roommate slash housemate of mine. So yeah, I have Ian Johns has stood the test of time, especially I think in limit games. He's always a guy to watch too in the 10K limit hold'em that I never enjoy having at my table, but always seem to. Really great player, obviously.
I'd like to bet he's not as smart as Ankenman, though.
He, I mean, I don't know about smart. He's definitely not as good as math, but I mean,
If it was a math contest, Ankenman would not be finishing second.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, Jared is going to win most math contests in that. But Ian Johns, Jared doesn't come out to the World Series of Poker anymore, so I like Ian's chances at most poker variants.
So the great story about Ian Johns in this event is that after day one, he was 201st out of 201 remaining players.
Wow.
He had bagged one big blind of 2,000 chips. So this is a great story. Like, you get down to half a bet or an ante or whatever, and people just kind of toss it in. I'm guilty of this myself. I'm like, what tournament can I go reg now? Or there's cash game, or people going for dinner.
At my table, he said his friend, bagged 4,400 or something in the Millionaire Maker. He was like, oh, do I even show up for day two? I'm like, I mean, are you crazy? Like,
of course
that's real equity. And of course, in the Colossus last week, we were just talking about the guy who was all in for a 500 ante in the Colossus, a tournament with 22,000 people in it.
Takes
and
it down.
I don't remember what was the starting stack of the Colossus. Do you have any idea?
No, I don't know.
Okay, I think it was 5,000 in the Colossus.
Sounds right.
So if I'm right about that, and even if I'm wrong, that's not a big deal. There are 110 million chips in the Colossus, and he had one 500 chip.
Yeah.
Okay. Like,
took it down.
What Ian does is obviously super impressive, but you talk about 1,500 horse, gets 1,000 people, so, it's 7.5 million in chips. It's still tremendously impressive, but you never give up, especially in tournaments. Here's the thing, of course, about short stacking tournaments is that you can double that up really quick, especially if there's a stud game.
If you're
involved,
playing stud, some sort of stud variant,
no limit hold'em, of course, because no limit hold'em.
If there's ante's going,
you basically get to 9x your stack, but you usually only have to beat one or two hands, right? Like, usually there's some guy raises and your heads up on the side heads up in the main, and he just gets the side. So yeah, I mean, it's never punt.
I don't have a ton. I don't play a ton of tournaments, but I have zero stories of taking like an ante or one big blind and spinning it up and cashing or going even on a run.
I've never been super short. I mean, I think everybody's been super short, but yeah, I don't have anything like that too. Of course, you witnessed, unfortunately, you mentioned your brother off the top, and we've mentioned the story of the show multiple times, of course, of I think he had the dude down to like half a big blind.
Three quarters of a big blind. He had them all in heads up for the...
And ends up finishing second for the bracelets. Yeah. The other guy overcomes, I mean, who knows what would it have been, like a 200-to-1 deficit or something like that?
The guy had, Matt Kikuan.
Matt Kikuan, yeah. And so, I mean, I don't know what Dan would have had, like chip lead-wise, maybe 100-to-1, 250-to-1, but yeah.
It was a lot.
Obviously, you know, if your head's up for a bracelet, it's a different story.
Yeah.
You should still, yeah, don't, it, treat it like high school football. Don't punt.
Do not punt. Interesting also at the final table of this event, he got heads up, Ian Johns got heads up with Justin Bonomo. And the players they'd played for so long, I guess, at the final table, that between them they had 36 big blinds. So like 18 each. Sorry, big bets.
Okay. Well, I mean, that's kind of... I think that's reasonable.
Is it? Because it seems small to me. It seemed 18... When your head's up, to have 18...
It is small, but I mean, I think limit tournaments just kind of naturally progress that way. Like you said, it might have been a long final table. I also think that horse, because you've got two split pot games, it tends to go even longer.
Right.
So the blinds get up there even more, so you know your relative stack size is smaller. I don't know if that's particularly that far out. To be perfectly honest, I'd have to look at. I mean, I think 1500 limit Hold'em is three-handed right now. I'd sort of be curious where they're at right now, because Hold'em, of course, isn't a split pot game. But I don't think that's way out of normal.
Well, rattle off some more of these results, maybe you can look it up, Sam. What they have.
Sure.
The final table of that event included Chris Fitch and Andre Akari and Scotty Baby. It made the final table. So
that's an awfully tough 1500.
Decent. Yeah, for 1500.
Let's be clear about that. Like that's. Like you get to a final table of 1500 a lot of time, you think, well, you know, I'm probably gonna be the best player at the table, you know, and so on and so forth. But yeah, when you got Ian Johns and Justin Bonomo, talk about two guys, by the way, who have stood the test of time.
Yep.
You know, we talked about this a bit last week, right? Like who's kind of been around forever, and those are two guys. Well, you mentioned Ian Johns is first bracelet in a decade apart. So but Justin obviously has been there, but two guys who are in their early-ish 30s, I'm guessing. You know, I don't know exactly how old either of them are, but, you know, certainly not old guys, but certainly standing the test of time. Limit Hold'em right now, three-handed.
Yep.
Danny Lee has 1.7 million. Tyler Monkowski, of the good Canadian kid.
Good Canadian kid, yeah.
Also 1.7 million, basically dead heat. And Scott Farnsworth in third with 1.2 million. And they are currently playing 25,000, 50,000 limits. So 50,000 is the big bet. So... Yeah, I mean, I guess you're kind of right. They look like they've got, I mean, so
80 big blinds or something? 85?
No. 1.7 million. So they've got so the two.
No, I'm saying total in play. How many big blinds are?
You're gonna make me do math. 35, like, 35, 70.
Somewhere in that range.
80, 85. So yeah, you're definitely right on this one. Of course, it's still three-handed. And it looks like it'll be three-handed for a while, because those are three very similar chip counts, 1.7, 1.7, 1.2. So, yeah, you know, maybe you're right. It did run for a while. I always thought that getting around 18 big bets each wasn't too uncommon, but maybe you're right.
Let's get on to event number 9, was the 10K Heads-Up Championship. 153 players entered.
Super soft tournament.
Yeah, this is the toughest tournament every year. Maybe the 25K 6 max, that kind of thing, or the Players' Championship. I wouldn't even say the Players' Championship, but this one is
pretty tough. I think there are a lot of, recreational folks who enjoy playing the Heads-Up Tournament.
Well, let's talk about one of them. This actually, it's funny, because... one of the guys who made the final was a guy named John Smith. He's a 69-year-old veteran from California. He almost ran the whole thing and took it down, which
you know
is amazing.
Weird? I tried to Google John Smith's information.
Good luck. John, there's a
it's
million
crazy.
John
I
Smiths.
Couldn't find it.
Yeah.
You know, there's apparently some other guy named John Smith.
The plays poker. But, you know, like you were saying, you know, in this age of internet whiz kids dominating this format, I mean, they play it nonstop, the experience they can get playing online. It was cool to see this guy, you know, he's opening up for 5X and doing all kinds of crazy stuff. Yeah. I mean, you know, they called
it. That'll help his cause, right? For sure. I mean, you're going to increase variance a bunch when that happens, opening, like making these very large opens. Like, you know, if you're on the other, if you're on the other side and, you know, you've got like a 10-4 suited, which would be a snap call normally, you know, when the guy is 2.5Xing it, then, you know, what? I don't know if these guys have experience playing to a 5X open with these, like, you know, small connectors and, you know, like, offsuit, you know, big card, low card, like King 5 and that kind of thing. Like, the spots that are automatic calls or even re-raises when you're in the big blind against, you know, another pro who's 2.5Xing it. And the other thing is, of course, I haven't played this event in a while. I used to play the 10K heads up, you know, back when I thought I was good relative to the field. and I used to play it, and the structures are pretty fast, and it's best of one, of course.
Right, and yeah, that's the big thing. Like, you know.
So this isn't a tournament, you know, that sort of crushes a lot of the amateur players. So when you've got a guy who's going to play a style like John Smith and is afraid, basically, like, the only way you could be drawing dead in a heads up no limit tournament is to, like, play small ball and fold too much, right? Like, that's kind of like the only way you can be drawing dead. But every other option, like, you can always cooler people, you can always kind of hang out even or sort of even until the blinds get really big, and then it's a shove contest, and, you know, you just need to win like two or three shoves in a row and you win. But, you know, I don't know that that's what happened. Who knows? Maybe John Smith is the man, and Galfond needs to take lessons from him. But you know, I don't know, but it's yeah, like you said, it's great to see.
He was making some crazy plays.
Yeah, they were.
He would just, like,
they called him unorthodox. It was nice. They actually used the word, like, to try and be nice to him.
Yeah, he would, like, call a raise with pocket sixes and then just, like, open ship, like,
on the king jack eight board.
Yeah,
he was doing crazy stuff. But, you know, it's.
What do you do there with if you're sitting there with, like, jack nine,
jack,
right?
10 or something? Yeah, what do you do?
I mean, what do you do? Like, is this the spot that you want to risk your tournament on? The dude could just have a king, and then you look awfully silly.
You know, and there's been talk of this for years about this tournament making it best of three, and I think back to, there was a Canadian heads up championship years and years ago that the CPT used to run. And it was best of three, and the structure was super deep.
That was a heads up tournament with value.
And you wonder, like, you know, I guess you don't really hear sort of the outcry for it, you know, on Twitter or anything by people, but it seems like if the World Series of Poker wanted to, they could go to a best of three with this one.
Yeah, I mean, I've definitely heard people express the sentiment 3-4 years ago, maybe, that it absolutely should be best of three. It's a prestige event. I think we're starting to get to a point where pros are starting to realize that they can't have all of the edges, right? So last week we talked about the top-up turbo, and you were very, you know, much against that, and I sort of, like, understood very much where you're coming from, and I definitely saw a lot of backlash from pros on Twitter that the top-up turbo event was really hurting the recreational players. That's sort of a sentiment that this is hurting rec, so we should do it in tournaments. That's a fairly new idea. I didn't hear anybody saying this in 2012, right? Back then, it was just all about, like, how do you maximize value? Like, how do we as poker players, gamblers, maximize value?
Win as much as we can, as fast as we can.
Exactly. And now we're starting to talk about, you know, things that, like, economists talk about. You know, of course, we had Andrew Barber on last week. You know, like, overfishing the pool. You know, like, do we get all the salmon out of the river and make all the money this year, or do we let the salmon spawn? You know, and hopefully we just get some income and we can be fishermen for a long time. And I think that's where we're starting to be at here.
Event 10 was the $1,500 six max that you were talking about earlier. Mike Cordell beats out 1,476 runners, won his first bracelet in 346,000. Event 11, the 10K dealer's choice. Haitian-born Jean Gaspard wins his first bracelet and 306,000.
That Haiti's first bracelet?
I would think.
We'll have to ask the KevMath or maybe Nolan Dollar or somebody like that. But yeah, you'd think that's Haiti's first bracelet, right?
I don't know if you saw this, but the last hand in this dealer's choice, Gaspard called No Limit Hold'em in the last hand. He called a raise pre with the deuce four off against the pocket tens.
He didn't call No Limit Hold'em so he could fold.
Yeah, exactly. And he ends up rivering two pair against the over pair of tens. that kind of bet the whole way, and they got it in, and the two pair won. So
clearly,
kind of
Paul's best game.
Event 12 was the $565 PLO. This was sort of the colossus for PLO. 2,483 entries.
Entry for the first, I don't know, 6 hours, 8 hours?
Was it? Is that what it was? Yeah. I didn't see the structure.
I remember we were actually, day one was when we were doing the show last week, and I was lamenting the fact that I don't get to donk it up with the four-card stuff just like everybody else.
Oh, right.
But,
and apparently it was the largest live non-hold'em tournament in history.
I believe that. I mean, I think there are some limit hold'em tournaments in history that might be larger, but yeah, I could believe this is the first not two-card.
They call it non-hold'em.
I can't even imagine what would be close, to be perfectly honest, right?
Well, PLO is huge in Europe, so you would have, for decades, it's been huge
but
in Europe.
They don't get 2,000-player fields.
No, they don't.
Any Europe, I mean, the big events in Europe don't get, like,
no.
You know, you get 1,000 players in Europe, that's pretty impressive.
Yeah, space is always an issue there,
right,
in casinos in Europe. Your champion is none other than friend of the PokerCast, Ryan LaPlante, who takes down his very first World Series of Poker bracelet, $190,000 as well. And I don't know, great story, first of all. Ryan, he's been on the show. We've had him here, of course. Everybody knows his story that listens to this show. And
so thrilled to have the bracelet. I mean, in an age
great.
Where people are kind of cynical about bracelets and stuff like that.
The pure joy, that he exhibited when he
right.
was handed his bracelet was really, really cool to watch. It's,
And for those of you, of course, who listened to last year when we had Ryan's little, I guess it was late last year, right? Like, he did this sort of World Series journal for us, of course. You know, you could tell poker means something to this guy. He's not just in it, you know, to put some zeros in his bank account and all this kind of stuff and pay the rent and grind out the rent money Kanish style. Like, he really likes being a part of the poker world. He likes enjoy this bracelet meant something to him. So it was definitely nice to see him get on the board.
At his bracelet ceremony, his fiance handed him his bracelet, and he said he wasn't going to, you know, really give a speech or anything. But then it was actually the day after the tragedy in Orlando, where, of course, Ryan is gay, openly gay, and the gay nightclub that was targeted by this psychopath. So Ryan felt like he wanted to say a few words, and it was quite touching for those that watched it. Asking people to treat each other with respect. I really liked his speech, T. I don't know if you saw it.
Yeah, I did. Like you said, very emotional. Ryan got very emotional for, like I said, not just because it's his first bracelet, but obviously it happening on the event of, you know, something that's we're going to be talking about for a while now, you know, something that's a big, you know, it's, you know, the biggest attack since 9/11, obviously, and the biggest mass shooting in U.S. history. It's a terrible event, and especially as a gay man, that's going to have a particularly heartfelt you know, effect on him. So, obviously a super emotional 24 hours for Ryan. He did a very good job, you know, collecting himself and, expressing himself. And yeah, I mean, I really liked, you know, he didn't try to make this a political thing, which
right.
I see everybody basically doing on Twitter, on Facebook and everything. Like, this is, you know, basically like whatever position you had on whatever, right? Like, whether it's gun rights or whether it's homophobia or you know, gay equality, like whatever, what, like, or Muslim immigration or Muslim terrorism or whatever your point of view is on these wide variety of things, everybody was just taking the opportunity to sort of say, well, aha, like, this is the political thing that I believe in, that the team that I cheer for is obviously right because this horrible thing happened. Ryan didn't do any of that. I mean, I'm sure Ryan has political views.
He didn't do it at the speech on Twitter when he's, you know, in social media and stuff. I think that's where a lot of people get their views out, and myself included, talking about gun rights and stuff. But yeah, you're right.
But Ryan didn't use this as a platform. He just said, like, let's have more love in the world, and let's treat each other with more love and treat each other with some decency. You know, instead of politicizing the issue, you know, obviously at what's a very, you know, tragic event.
Indeed.
So yeah.
Event 13 was the $1,500 seven card stud event. Somehow Grapes didn't win this one. But recent guest, the karma continues. Recent poker guest, Rep Porter, ends up taking down his third bracelet in $142,000. Another great final table or a couple of deep runs by some great players, including Daniel Negreanu in fourth and Sean Deeb in eighth. But cool for Rep to take that down. His third bracelet, you know, Rep's going to be around for a long time. He's going to win a lot of bracelets.
Yes, definitely. Plays all the variants, plays all the time,
really
plays
well.
Cash. So he's very comfortable in every variant. So, yeah, I mean, I'm almost surprised Rep only has two. Definitely one of those ones where he might even be underperforming his bracelet count.
Event 14 was the $1,500 millionaire maker that you talked about earlier as well.
Oh, I have a correction.
Sure.
It was actually a Raz tournament.
That
wasn't stud.
The rep one?
Yeah,
was it Raz?
I was thinking rep one.
Yeah, rep one Raz.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Research on this stuff, so I...
You were trusting me?
I was like, I didn't
Don't
want to
trust me.
You.
This show's slapped together in like 2 hours. Come on.
Yeah. And by the way, Grapes did go run deep in this one. It was one of the ones where he finished 12th. So
I said he didn't win it. I didn't say he didn't go deep.
Yes, he didn't win it.
Event 14, I'm fairly sure, was a no limit hold'em affair with the $1,500 millionaire maker. Some cool stories.
Here's correction. It was Indian poker.
Hey, that's blind man's bluff.
Right? It's now called
blind. Oh,
it's the poker correct.
I'm
blind
sorry.
Man's bluff. Yeah.
Well, 7,190 people entered the blind man's bluff event, which was won by
that's
Jason DeWitt, San Diego.
Jason DeWitt from San Diego takes it down. But some cool stories. I don't know if you watched this one, T. Lisa Meredith, who is a kindergarten teacher from Vancouver, Washington, made a deep run. First of all, let's talk about the structure.
Holy cow! Let's talk about the structure.
I don't know. Do you have an hour?
The payout structure, not the blind and nanny structure.
No. The payout structure. So the first prize was here's the problem. They guaranteed it's called the Millionaire Maker. They guaranteed first and second is $1,000,000. So first was like $1,050,000, and second was $1,000,000, and third was $500,000. So the problem.
Say that again, because I want that to sink in for those who somehow managed to miss this.
Third
place, $500,000. Second place, $1,000,000. First place, $1,050,000+ in change. Like basically like a used Lexus on top. Like, I mean, what is like? Do they even give a shit?
Once they guaranteed first and second $1,000,000, they were screwed. And this happens a lot of the time when you have these goofy guarantees. You think back to, we've talked about it before, the very first Party Poker Million, first was $1,000,000 and second was 79,000.
Aussie Millions did the same thing where like second place was like 110 after they guaranteed $1,000,000. We've seen it when they guaranteed $1,000,000. The first time they did $1,000,000 for the November 9th, like 9th place on the November 9th, there was like this ridiculous page up between 9th and 10th, and then like 8th, 7th, and 6th was basically like paid for extra in and out, milkshakes.
Right.
This is terrible. Like, this is terrible. And they, I don't know at what point this was announced, to be perfectly honest. Because do you know if they guaranteed two millionaires before the series started?
Compounded this issue was they changed the payout structure to paying 15% of the field. So now when you combine those two things and you have a smaller turnout, and now you're going to have this ridiculous spot. It was two decisions made separately, but they didn't think about what the sum of these two decisions was, what was going to happen, right?
But did they actually say that we're going to do two millionaires? Like, I don't remember when this said, and maybe, I mean, I don't follow all the press conferences and all this nonsense, but I almost feel like they just sort of decided like, hey, we've close enough that we could do two millionaire, like, because they probably, like, I feel like they just ran the structures the other way and second place comes out to whatever, like 837,000 or whatever reasonable normal payout number would be, and then they're just like, well, we could round that up to $1,000,000 and take some of it off the third, and what's happening?
Yeah, and I don't see any reason why they had to pay second place $1,000,000. It's a millionaire maker, first place wins $1,000,000. You don't need to have
it's not the millionaire's maker,
right? Exactly.
They're doing it completely for publicity, and there was massive outcry everywhere, and they refused to give a shit. This is bad. This is embarrassing. Like, I mean, I want to give the WSOP credit for doing a lot of things right, and they do a lot of things right, but then they just go and blow it up by doing things like this that drive people crazy, right? Like, we've talked about how what a great move it was to hire Kev Math. You know, we're super happy about that. They've done other things. They've fixed the structures. Last year, the structures were really weird, and now people are really happy with structures. So I hate dwelling on these small things, but these negative things, but it's the negative things that really jump out. And when you do it like this, it's really blatantly obvious because everybody knows this. Like, my girlfriend knows that
it's
this
not
is
a, it's not a small – it's such a glaring error that shows a complete lack of understanding.
Second pays double what third pays, and first pays 5% more than right. first place. Like, you know, this is not in any way remotely reasonable. You're playing a satellite. You're basically at three-handed. You're now playing a super satellite. I was hearing that the last two guys, because they're basically playing for a bracelet and 50,000 or whatever, like, they were drinking at the table. They're rail, like, they apparently, I think, know each other and were like friends or roommates or something like that.
Well, it's Garrett Greer. Garrett Greer finished second, yeah.
Yeah, okay. So, like, you know, their friends, like, even just bothered to stop railing, like, hey, we're going to go to the club and celebrate. Like, I mean, if the WSOP wants to make this big thing about, oh, like, this is so prestigious and the bracelet matters so much, and we, oh, yeah, don't forget, while I'm ranting, of course, they refuse to do deals, right?
And this is the place where there should be, it screams deal.
It screams deal.
Because you're playing a three-handed freeze-out.
I don't know if two pros are going to make a deal with a kindergarten teacher, right? So
right.
we've got...
right. No,
like,
but...
We certainly...
That's results-oriented.
Yeah. It could, but it could have been a third pro
right.
at the third table, and then they're just in this massively effed-up ICM situation, and they were definitely want to make a deal. But, and then they'll stand by it and say, oh, well, we don't do deals because it affects the integrity of the brace.
No, the payout structure and the effect of the integrity.
They're now heads up and they're shotgunning beers. I mean, come on. Like, they're playing for no money. They've already just banked a million. Like, are you serious?
I was cheering for the kindergarten teacher the whole way. I thought it was a great story. She, again, from Vancouver, Washington, her and her husband looked at the schedule this year, and they had circled the deep stack, the 1500 deep stack event that they wanted to travel to Vegas and play in. Her parents, I guess, were going to be the one to watch the kids, and they weren't available that weekend, so they decided, okay, we'll go to the Millie Maker when we can get some babysitting. So super cool story. She's been off for a couple of years, I think, on maternity leave, and then decided that she wasn't going to go back anytime soon because she's now taking down a $500,000. But she's
that almost surprises me because I feel like kindergarten teachers
are in it for the
it's almost one of those jobs where, you know, nobody decided to be a kindergarten teacher for the money, right?
So she plays $20 MTTs at her local pub in Portland.
Nice.
And I guess each month this club has a bigger once a month it has a bigger tournament, maybe $100 buy-in or something. She's won it the last two times. So, okay. I mean, but I was watching, I don't know if you watched or followed any of the coverage, but she's, and I watched some of the live stream. She was,
I did hear that her play was
pretty nitty.
Unorthodox is the word we're using.
Well, she was just tight. I mean, she was obviously, you know, when you start to look
But did she call it off really light on her bust out hand?
I can't remember. I didn't see her bust out.
Somebody told me that she called, like, three handed, of course, and we're talking about this huge bay jump, that I think she. Three bet with King 10, and then one of the two guys shoved big, and she called it off with King 10. And I guess I shouldn't speculate because if I don't know practically how it right. happened, and she called it off with King 10, which I think in a linear chip situation, fine, but in a weird sort of funky satellite situation, maybe a little bit, maybe not what you would want to do. But I mean, again, this. I mean, I'll just start ranting about the payout structures.
Yeah.
Again. Like it shouldn't have happened to begin with.
Oh, and it's difficult for her to, you know, expect her to understand how to play this much differently.
Well, the ITM stuff,
for sure. The other awesome story we mentioned, Garrett Greer, he's been a guest on the PokerCast before. This man, you'll remember, I think, he had a horrible fall and lost a large majority of his motor skills. So very, very cool and happy for Garrett. It's his second $1 million score. And he turned to poker because with the loss of the use of some of his limbs that he couldn't... I think he was in show business in L.A. He was an intern and couldn't do all the stuff that he wanted to do to be in that business. And he'd played poker and decided that after his injury that he was going to turn to poker to try and make his living. And he's done quite well. So
That's one of the reasons I love poker, actually. Like, you know, we can get cynical about it sometimes, but it's definitely a great competitive outlet for people who don't have that anymore. I mean, the case that I, of course, think about is we know so many retired professional athletes, your brother among them, who turn to poker because they're inherently competitive people and they love competing. But, there always comes a time. I mean, not everybody suffers a situation like Garrett Greer. Not everybody gets put in a wheelchair or has, you know, physical or other disabilities and stuff like that. But poker is tremendously egalitarian in that way. Obviously, Halabarsky is able to play. We got guys in their 90s playing, which we talked about last week. That's one of the really great things about poker is as long as you got a brain and as long as you can put chips in the middle, you get to play and maybe you get to win second place for $1 million even though you should have won $800,000.
I wonder if they made a deal for the $50,000. Chop up to $50,000. You mentioned professional players. Neymar was at the World Series of Poker this week, of course, Neymar Jr.
Right.
I guess he didn't have time to play. He wasn't there for long enough to be able to play a 2 or 3 day event. So he ended up playing in a two-table satellite for a main event seat with 20 guys, and he ended up taking it down.
Awesome.
Which was kind of cool.
We need more turbos. Like, that's the thing. If we want to get these guys like Neymar who got shit to do.
Dude's
got
to get on a plane. He's out of here.
Exactly.
But now,
maybe we get one of like the Warriors or the Cavaliers to just come in on the game day off between Game 6 and Game 7, pop in a turbo, and come back and play Game 7.
Iguodala's into the white magic. He's been on Jimmy Kimmel talking about it. Maybe he'll jump in. Game 7, of course, coming up Sunday.
I was going to say, are we now what's going on? We're definitely getting to Game 7, right?
We are. The Cavs won tonight, so Game 7.
Getting to Game 7. All right.
On Sunday, cancel your Father's Day plans for people out there.
Yeah, exactly.
I know what I want for Father's Day, to sit in front of the TV and watch basketball.
Exactly. Leave me the F alone.
Quiet. But Neymar, so he takes down this. Do you think he gets Lamb? He must, right? They're not going to make
everybody
any special.
I would certainly hope he gets Lammers.
He gets Lammers, yeah. So what's he going to do with these? Can you see Neymar standing in the cage lineup going, hey, I got some Lammers here, dude. Do you want to buy these for 5% less than ever?
Yeah, I mean, somebody will explain it to him. I mean, I bet if I'm one of the dudes in the satellite, like, and you kind of get this clearly inexperienced guy, you might try to buy it off him for $9,500 or something like that. And he'll probably snap do it if he doesn't know any better.
Event 15 was the $1,500 eight game. Paul Volpe takes down his second bracelet in $150,000. Old G. Smith, final table, ended up in sixth. Good to see Gavin getting a result there. Event 16 was the 10K deuce to seven, no limit deuce, sorry, championship. So let's talk about this one. We're going to be here for a while if we jump right into this. First of all, Benny Glazer, who's in our fantasy league, and is actually leading the Pokercast Fantasy League at the moment. He made the final table. He also picked himself and his fantasy team. Good to see him backing it up. And Jason Mercier takes down his fourth bracelet, $273,000 for first. But there's all kinds of interesting stuff going on around this final table, too, so let's jump into this. Jason Mercier made a bet with Vanessa Selbst at the PCA this year in January in the Bahamas. Now, Vanessa had made a bet a couple of days earlier with Dmitry Urbanovich that Dmitry came up and wanted a line on him winning three bracelets at Vegas this year, the World Series of Poker in Vegas, not the Europe or South Asia or wherever they're having it.
You got to win all three in Vegas.
Got to win all three in Vegas. And, of course, Dmitry had been on an amazing run, and he was finally old enough to go to Vegas and play in the World Series in the summer. So he asked Vanessa, I guess, maybe serious joking or semi-seriously for a line, and Vanessa said, okay, I'll give you 200-1, but you have to bet $10,000. Or Dmitry decided on the $10,000 figure.
I was going to say, it seems weird for Vanessa to have insisted on that when she's the one with the $2 million exposure.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, so they ended up bidding $10,000, 200-1. And Vanessa collected the $10,000 from Dmitry, had to post up. So a couple of days later, Jason Mercier hears about this bet and thinks, well, hang on a second, what would my line be? And I guess they're at a party. They're at a Stars Pro function. Vanessa had had a bunch to drink, and apparently had when she made the bet with Dmitry as well. And Jason asks her what the line for him would be, and they started negotiating down. If Dimitri's 200, Jason's less because he's mixed game wizard,
more experience,
etc. Yep. So they ended up at 180-1, and Jason gave her the $10,000. And booked the bet. So now she's got $1.8 million in exposure for Jason and $2 million for Dmitry. Now, I'll read some of her tweets about what she said. Well, why don't we do that now? So basically what happened was she took to Twitter after Jason won this event and was going deep in the 10K Raz. I think he was 10th out of 42 left, and she hit Twitter and started talking about the bet and the fact that she was quite unhappy and felt that Jason maybe might have taken advantage of the fact that she was drunk when she booked the bet with him. And I guess she had been quite upset about it after and tried to buy out, and Jason didn't seem too interested in letting her buy out for $1,000. She offered $1,000, but seemed like she wanted to, she thought that Jason should probably just say, "Oh, you were drunk, fine, we'll cancel the bet," kind of thing. So here, I'll read what she said. She wrote sort of a notepad note and put it out on Twitter. "I'm going to write a longer blog about this sometime, but for now I just want to clear up what went down in these bets, since there's a lot of confusion and 140 characters is difficult. Day one, I get really drunk with Dimitri and make a bad, dumb bet." I don't know that it's a bad bet. I was
accessed, and I haven't modeled it. I actually think it's probably slightly plus EV.
I think so too. But, Kelly Criterion, et cetera.
Right. If you actually talk about her bankroll, unless her bankroll is $50 million, and it seems fairly unlikely that it is.
Right.
It's a bad bet from an exposure and a bankroll.
Strictly EV-wise, it doesn't seem
strictly
too bad.
Strictly EV-wise, that is not an insane line by any stretch of the imagination.
So, again, day one, I get really drunk with Dimitri and make a bad, dumb bet. Day two, I'm filled with regret about said bet. Day three, I get really drunk and decide that the way to alleviate my anxiety about the first bet is to book more action, since it's almost impossible multiple people win the bet. Not the best logic, I realize after the fact. Day four, I explain situation and ask Jason to cancel, then buy out for $1,000. We stop talking pretty quickly when he seems uninterested. Today I explained to Jason how I was disappointed he didn't let me buy out or cancel either. I offered a generous buyout amount of $100,000. And he refused. I'm not calling Jason evil. I'm saying I expected him to be more compassionate towards me given the nature of the bet and situation. He didn't, and that was unfortunately how he chose to handle it. Multiple people can attest that I refused their action at 181 in the following months, and Jason is a better player than them. I said as much. I chose not to publicize this bet because I wasn't proud of it, nor did I want to even think about it. I unfortunately made the bet with Dimitri in front of press, so that became public instantaneously. Only Jason mentioned this bet before the World Series of Poker, never me. So everyone's saying it's just sour grapes. Obviously, I don't give a fuck if he doesn't win a bracelet, and it's better if the story never came out. But now that it's relevant, I just thought that the story mattered. Those are my thoughts. I don't want to belabor any of this, and not looking for sympathy. I just thought it mattered. So a lot of people were really kind of, you know, when she came out and said this after Jason had won a bracelet and was looking pretty good in the Raz, that, you know, why do you come out now and say you've got the $10,000? You asked him to post up. You had months before the World Series of Poker, and you know, to negotiate some sort of buyout. If you know Jason walked away and didn't seem interested, you can still go back and try and buy out at some point. If this bet really, you really don't want to have this bet. Also, you may be able to go out and spend some time trying to hedge it, because it doesn't, as we were saying earlier, it seems fairly decent bet if you can, you know, lay it off over many people, right?
Right.
So, just on that point, well, first, give me your initial thoughts on the bet itself and the fact that she waited until, like, if he didn't win a bracelet, would we have heard about this at this point?
Probably not. My thoughts on this is it's kind of a train wreck on all sides.
It is.
To be really honest. One thing you didn't even mention, by the way, or maybe you were going to get to it, of course, both of these guys, Team Poker Stars pros, so you can only imagine how the big heads at Stars, or whoever's the sponsorship manager / pro manager at this point, super thrilled about this, I'm sure. A bunch of things. So the sort of initial reaction I had was, okay, taking advantage of people who are drunk is bad and you shouldn't do it. And, you know, like, maybe you should think about offering a buyout. On the other hand, 1K is not a reasonable buyout if you make a stupid bet. I mean, for a bet of this size, like, you know, paying 1K is pretty lame. As you
presumably
said,
it's the ten. So for her buying out $1,000, she'd already collected the $10,000 from Jason. So it would be giving Jason the $10,000 back plus $1,000.
Yeah. So, but I mean, he probably thinks he got it in better than that. Like, I don't know how he would calculate his edge, but I don't know. But to me, the bigger thing is, so first of all, I definitely think Vanessa should be bound to the bet. To her credit, she hasn't remotely even suggested that
no,
she shouldn't have to pay, right? So she has the full awareness that it's on her, and like it's her responsibility, and if she loses the bet, she's going to have to pay. At least it seems that way.
Well, for those for those that are hating on Vanessa for this, a lot of people would have taken the $10,000, gone back to Jason the next day and said, look, I was drunk. Here's the $10,000 back. The bet's off. I don't care what you say. The bet's off. She didn't do that. She tried to buy out. She tried to do the honorable thing. Jason wasn't interested. And this is what occurred. Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you. But
No. That's totally fine. And that's I think, very relevant to the situation. Of course, we won't know. Unless Jason actually wins three bracelets, we don't know what Vanessa say. But at least at this point, she's saying the right things, right? And of course, obviously, we alluded to the Raz. Spoiler alert, Jason didn't win. So he's a pretty big dog, right? Like, even if Jason had won the Raz, he's still it's still got to be like 5-6, 7-1 against winning a third bracelet with 25 events to go. So he's still a dog. So, like, from this sense, we don't actually know where she is, and maybe she actually doesn't know where she is. From Jason's point of view, I kind of feel like he should just have taken, I mean, if he was really legitimately offered a 100K buyout, which I'm kind of surprised by that, or I'm kind of surprised that he doesn't negotiate something with her, simply because when you make a prop bet with another poker player and that poker player's downsize is 1.8 million, like, there's a good chance you won't get paid. Regardless of how honorable or how ethical Vanessa Selbst is, I'm not calling that into question at all, but you're not betting with Bill Perkins here.
Right.
You know, you're just betting with somebody else who plays cards for a living.
But you have no real idea of their financial situation.
You have no idea of their financial situation.
They're not close friends.
You probably don't have any legal recourse. I could be wrong. Like, I don't know. I was talking a bit, I don't know if he wants to be mentioned, so I'll just be honest. With somebody in the poker media, you know, basically kind of was explained to me that for, you know, the only way that there would be legal recourse is if Vanessa could demonstrate that she was taken advantage of in her being
right, but
state,
I don't think she would ever do that.
Okay. Not only would she never do that, you would have a bunch of experts presumably saying that 180-1 is a reasonable line, right? Which you and I have just said. I think if you survey a bunch of people in the poker world, they'll tell you that 180-1. Yeah, Jason Mercier is a great player, but man, it's really fucking hard to win three. Who's the last guy to win three bracelets in a year?
Like 10 Michael Mizrachi, I think.
Mizrachi? How long ago was that?
No. Was it Mizrachi? No, it was, you know who it was? Jeffrey Lissandro.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, the three stud events.
It's
true,
three stud
events. I mean, it's happened like once this decade, among all the people who grind out like lots of tournaments. I mean, there's probably, I don't know, what do you say? There's probably about like 40 or 50 people every year who like play everything, right?
Yep.
And precisely one person has managed to win three bracelets in the last year.
Lots of people win two. Mizrachi never won three, no. Yeah. But a lot of people win two, yeah.
Yeah, I'm talking about two. So that, to me, from Jason's point of view, simply as like a business person, I feel like he probably should have negotiated some sort of buyout. I don't think he's ethically obligated to do so. I don't think he's done anything wrong. This is a world that we live in where, listen, this sounds harsh, but we in the poker world take advantage of drunk people all the time. Drunk guy sits down at your table. You're just playing your 5-10 game at your local casino. Some guy's bombed out of his mind, buys in for $20,000. You're not thinking about, boy, we better protect this guy from himself because he's not in a state to be playing poker. There is you're trying not to drool all over the felt.
So what I'll say about that though is I don't know how it can be decided or Vanessa can think that she was taken advantage of because she was drunk, because Jason had heard that she'd made this and probably confirmed with her that she'd made this exact same bet a couple of days ago.
Right.
If the fact was that she was drunk then, you know, she would have never made this bet again. If she had been upset about it and unhappy that she made the bet, there's zero chance she would offer it to Jason again and talk about it. So I don't get that at all. That part is
very
lost on me.
And it certainly doesn't make Vanessa look good, like, oh, I get drunk at parties and make dumb prop bets.
Well, I mean, they're at the PC. I get that or whatever. But yeah, you're right. I just don't see
making their drunk prop bets for $1.8 million.
Yeah, right.
You know, $2 million in the case of Dimitri. I mean, the word compassion is interesting, I think, in this context, right? Vanessa is such an incredibly well-spoken person, very good with language. Obviously, she's a lawyer. The fact that she chose to use the word, expected him to be more compassionate towards me, I think is really interesting because, you know, I don't see, you know, this is sort of like an honor among thieves situation. And I have a hard time seeing that Jason's done something wrong here.
Yeah, I totally agree. I think Jason is in the right. I don't know that he should have been expected to absolutely make a deal or anything like that. I am a bit confused, again, why Vanessa thinks that he took advantage of the situation or anything like that.
Considering, like we said, it's not, and it's probably a good bet for her slightly in terms of in terms of variance. But yeah, I think it's not that bad. And you know, what's interesting is that she's intelligent enough that, you know, when Jason was stacking all the chips in the res, she started betting on Jason, of course, against other people, offering other people what she thought was a good price to win two bracelets, right? And I thought about this, and I almost started doing the math on this, seeing if I wanted the other side, because she said she wanted 25-1. You said Jason, you said it was Jason wasn't the chip leader at the time yet, but he was still doing quite well. I think I was started thinking this, and I'm thinking, like, actually that's not a great price, because the thing is if you can make a good first bet for too much of your bankroll if you have the option to lay it off and make not too bad bets later, right? So we talked about this a bit when we do like sort of our March Madness stuff with Alan Boston. He's got our guys, you know, he's got the teams that he thinks could win the whole tournament, right? So if you've got a dog and you happen to bet a bunch of them, you know, and it pays off at like whatever 18-1, you can bet against that team, you know, in the Final Four or whatever, and even though you're taking slightly the worst of it, the bet is still positive overall because the initial bet was so good. And Vanessa's, of course, very sharp, immediately started going like, I need to lay off some action. And then she did that. And good for her, because she did that and she lost those side bets because, like I said, Jason didn't win. And then, you know, she's now got it in very good because Jason's probably not going to win two more bracelets. I mean, yeah, he's doing good in the horse, but I mean, chances are he's
still a
well
big dog,
21 or whatever to win these bracelets. And then Vanessa tweets, and I was just really like unimpressed by Vanessa tweeting this. Is, well, first of all, she said like, okay, I'm done tweeting about this topic, and then less than 24 hours later, she says, I lost almost 100K in buyouts, and I have many of you brilliant Twitter minds saying that I welched on a bet. Auto block mode engaged. And I get that. I mean, I get that people would be, she would be, she's very justifiably mad that if people are saying that she wants to welch, but you didn't lose, you did lose 100K in buyouts, but what you gained was a whole bunch of equity from Ray D taking out Jason. So why are you mad about, like,
yeah.
I just don't understand why.
And don't just announce you're going to block people, just block people. Like, just do it. The other thing, and Jason made a good point. He said, am I supposed to just refund? Remember, he had Olivier's side in the fight against JC, and he booked a lot of action and won a ton of money on that bet. And he's like, well, should I just refund all those people because they might have been drunk when it happened?
I can't imagine how many tens of thousands of dollars I've won off drunk people at the poker table. It's probably a lot,
right?
Considering when a lot of that would have been online poker, and I don't even know that they're drunk, right? I used to get this when I worked at Stars. People were like, oh, I was drunk and donked off my bankroll. Can I have it back? Like, what do you – like, I mean, they usually don't say it like that, but they're usually – they're asking for – and again, here's this word again, compassion, right? But it's like, what do you want us to do? Go into the other guy's account and take off the 20K? Like, what are you going to do? You got drunk and you signed up for a bunch of 5K heads-up sit-and-goes against people who are better at poker than you. I'm sorry. Like,
yeah.
What are we supposed to do about this?
And the other thing, and I mentioned it earlier, was if she had a lot of time, months and months and months, to take this bet to many, many people. Vanessa knows tons and tons of people in the high-stakes poker community. Again, the price isn't crazy. If she was having trouble selling off some of the bets, she could have discounted it a bit. She could have spread her exposure out easily over the months.
She could have even, she could have given other people 200-1, right? Just so her exposure isn't that bad. You know, I bet somebody, you know, there are definitely people in the poker world, or at least consortiums in the poker world, that are bankrolled properly to take
that bet.
Exactly. Yeah. Like, you talk about, you know, like if a bunch of Germans got together and did the math and figured that Jason is actually, whatever, 320-1 or something like that, they'd be like, oh, yeah, maybe we should, you know, maybe we should buy up some of this action at you know, and get Vanessa to give us 251. She takes a small loss. She learns a lesson. She doesn't lose $2 million.
Right.
And, you know, and then this fails to be a story, and we can kind of go on with our lives.
So this is the beautiful thing about poker players, though. And it doesn't happen that I've ever seen, because I have many groups of friends that are not poker players. They're hockey, but whatever. When you say something in a group of poker players, and you've got to back it up, and somebody calls you on it, you either have to back off your position or follow it up with a bet. I mean, it's just, that's what happens.
I've said this, 18 million times on the show, right? But that's sort of like the beautiful thing about the world that we live in, is that you can just back up your opinion with betting. Absolutely.
That's great. Somebody in the post, there was a big thread on it in NVG, of course, and a poster named Punker posted, this is the ideal scenario. Mercier wins the Raz for a second bracelet. Mercier bricks until event 65. Mercier plays the 10K and in the 10K Women's Championship.
He's got the 10K to play the 1K Women's event.
He sits down next to Vanessa, and he wins the Women's the prop bet, and Vanessa goes pretty up, you know, crazy, obviously.
I know who Punker is. He's actually a very good friend of mine.
Oh, and, he's funny.
I love the imagination on that one.
That was good. It looks like the drama is over because Vanessa sold off enough. She put out 100K. Jason didn't win the bracelet, although he's deep now in the 10K horse that's going on right now. So, and you know, there's some events left, some very short field events left. That
There's a 25K. There's obviously the one drop.
Yep.
There's a lot. I think there's maybe four or five 10K events left to go. But yeah, I mean, it's going to be tough, but I mean...
There's the tag team event where he can just, like, pick Fetter and pay him a bunch of money to go play, or some, you know, no-limit wizard to go play, right? I think...
Oh, that's right.
To qualify, he's just got to play, like, one lap or something, I think.
Yeah. That's the most weirdly designed tournament ever. Yeah, like...
So
yeah,
he can play another tournament at the same time.
Who do you want your team partner to be? That's a really
good one. Yeah, you just go pay them however much it takes.
Okay, so a quick up-to-the-minute Jason update is he is third in the 10K horse. There are 26 left. He has 790,000 chips. This is a tournament started with 171,000, 171 players with 50,000 chips. So a little quick math on that. I think that comes out to 85 million chips. So yeah, he's got like 1% of the chips or something like that. So
That was event 20 we were talking about. No, that was event 16.
Yeah.
Again, Benny Glazer, who final tabled. Congrats goes out to him. Hope for more success for him. Event 17 was the 1K No Limit Hold'em event, another one. Chase Bianchi wins his first bracelet. It's actually his first cash ever, which is kind of cool. Event 18 was the 3K horse.
It's even better when it's like their first handed mob cash.
And right.
And you see.
That's awesome.
I don't know if that's the case, but that's pretty awesome.
Yeah, and Lisa Meredith, it was her second handed mob cash. I think she'd won $10,000 one time.
They don't put the $40
They don't put Portland tournaments. Event 18, 3K horse. Crazy Marco Johnson takes it down, winning his second bracelet. Event 19, the 1K PLO Sam Soverell wins his first bracelet. Event number 20, sorry, just lost my place in the notes here. Event 20 was the...
No Limit Deuce to 7.
No Limit Deuce to 7. Is that right?
The World Championship.
Right. So, and this, when the bet all went down, when Vanessa took to Twitter, Jason was 10th. Sorry, he was 10th out of 42 left. And he ended up going on a really deep run, got to the final table. Final table was fantastic. I watched some of it. I got spoiled by Pokercast Ross over here. What happened was my kid had a game, so I put it on. And this is great.
The Raz. This is now the Raz. You wrote. You threw me off, actually, by putting No Limit Deuce in the notes, but Event 20 was the Raz.
Oh, sorry, Event 20 was the Raz, yeah.
Yeah. But everything else you said was correct. Yeah, so Jason deep, got lots of chips in the tournament.
And I hit pause. When I'm watching the replayer on WSOP.com, I hit pause, and it buffers. It's really cool. Like, you can buffer three or four hours.
It's not like, a lot of stuff, when you pause, like, live sporting events, it'll just, when you unpause it, it'll just go back to live, right?
Yeah.
The WSOP doesn't work that way, so you can watch it. As you like it.
So I backed up the Raz. My kid had a game. I backed it up 3 or 4 hours, came back to sit down, and Roscoe hits me on Twitter with Mercier busted. So
I don't feel like that's his... I'm gonna back Ross up on this one, because I don't feel like poker spoilers are even a thing.
They're not a thing. When you're following stuff on
Twitter...
You
never mentioned it.
No, I'm
you
not.
You know that I follow these things,
exactly.
Too.
If you had said...
No spoilers.
You know, It's not like it's any of our jobs to like follow poker and figure out what's going on for a
right.
And you initiated the conversation by asking me to do something.
I did, yeah. I cannot... and plus, you saved me like 4 hours of watching Raz. So it was fine. So anyway, Jason goes on a super deep run. The final table was really interesting. Bart Hansen, a friend of the show, was there. November Niner, John Reisner. Serial cheater Brian Hastings was there. Jason Mercier. and nosebleed cash player Ray Edenka... Rady was there.
Let's save you that one. Rady.
He apparently plays in the nosebleed four horse events and mixed game events.
Rage was telling me, actually, I think... I don't remember how many players left when he said this, but he said he played a lot of actual heads-up Raz with Rady on the internet, which he just found out during this event, and he thought that Ray was probably actually the strongest threat to Jason. You know, Jason's obviously a request for a second bracelet. He thought that Rady, of course, once himself was eliminated from the tournament, was probably his biggest threat or one of his biggest threats.
Turned out to be true. Rady took the event down, beating Jason Mercier, ended up in second. You know, close call again right there. That's finishing second. A pretty close call for Vanessa. I think somebody tweeted, and I retweeted it, was that congrats to Vanessa Selbst for winning the 10K Raz, because the expectation she picked up was
yeah,
pretty
she
big.
She picked up a lot of equity. She was a very big Ray D fan.
Yeah, indeed. That's going to wrap up the recap of this week in the World Series of Poker. We'll get to more next week and break down some of the stuff that goes on this week. After the break, we're going to be joined by Mr. Brandon Shak Harris.
Or Brandon Shak Harris.
Yeah.
We got one confirmed yet?
And I think Brandon's going to join us at 9:30 on his break. And then in the third segment, we're going to get to Ross reports, a mailbag. We get a voicemail as well. Roscoe, what do you got to say about PLOQuickPro.com?
Yeah. PLOQuickPro.com, as we know, is the number one training site for PLO players. It is the only site with an entire suite of PLO courses designed by WSOP bracelet winner John Beaupre and 5K PLO scoop winner Alien Slayer. Terrence, have you seen John around the Rio?
I sent him an email the day before the 1K PLO, and he said he just went back to Denver. So I just I was shocked he did not play the 1K PLO, but he says he's coming back. So I'm definitely looking forward to meeting him in person and talking about some four card.
He posted on Twitter a giant stack. It was like noon, and he's like, I woke up and started grinding, and he had like, I think it was like 30K. In front of him at a PLO game.
Nice.
Pretty good for noon. So if I decide to play the 3K PLO on Saturday, then I'm sure I'll run into him that point. But hopefully I'll just be making a drive to the final table.
You got some time. Then you can review the material on PLOQuickPro.com for that tournament.
Yeah. Over the past few years, they've successfully taught more than 1,000 players how to master the fundamentals, increase their win rate, and move up in stakes for good. So whether you're a smaller micro-stakes grinder and you're trying to become a winner, you're a winning player and you're looking to make more money, and especially if you're a no-limit player looking to make the transition to the four-card game. They've got videos, PDFs, and tutorials to help you plug your leaks and look at the game in a new way. So if you'd like to learn the guaranteed fastest way to master the fundamentals, increase your win rate, and move up in stakes for good, visit PLOQuickPro.com/pokercast to get your very own personalized PLO curriculum. You can also reach out to John personally at john@PLOQuickPro.com if you'd like to learn more.
All right. After the break, Brandon Shak Harris. You're listening to the 2+2 Pokercast presented by the PokerStars VIP Club. More right after this.
500 Zoom 6 Max, 370 big blinds deep. I open button with a min raise with queen out of clubs. Greg Merson calls on the small. Flop comes deuce 4 queen with diamonds flush draw. He leads 1750 and I raise to 55. He 3 bets to 172 and I call. Turn is a brick, deuce of clubs, and he bets 2/3 of the pot. I call. River is a king of hearts, leaving the flush draws missed. And Greg Yover bets the pot big, betting $1,470 into $785 pot. I felt like he might be pushing me off my hand, so I called and was good against his 10-9 of diamonds.
Team Pro Online's Mikhail Inasai Shalamov is a Supernova VIP. This is the 2+2 PokerCast, presented by the PokerStars VIP Club.
Okay, people, most of the kittens have perished. There are a few left you can save, though, and here's how to do it. Get involved with the PokerCast by emailing your questions, suggestions for the show, or even record a sound clip. Adam will be using the best ones on the air. Well, let's face it, probably the worst ones as well. I can see you there at your computer. Send an email right now. Totally disagree with one of Adam's takes last week? Send an email. Love last week's interview? Email. Want to know how much cash Adam has on him right now? Email. Pokercast at 2plus2.com is the address. Ship the funny to Adam today. Attention everyone not named Alan Kessler. Have someone you would love to appear on the Pokercast? Have someone you don't want to hear again on the Pokercast? Head on over to the suggested guest thread in the Pokercast forum at 2plus2.com and Adam will do his best to make you happy. P.S. Chainsaw, you can post too.
You said I'll come back for you, my love. Wait for me, you say you're the only, you've been the only one I love, and love believe. The love is a bird that you kept in your coat, warm until it died in the dark. And death is the love of what hurts you the most, so you drink it day away till you warm as paradise.
Welcome back, everybody, to the 2 Plus 2 PokerCast brought to you by the PokerStars VIP Club. I am Terrence Chan, and unfortunately, during the last segment, Adam received a message. He's had a family emergency. Unfortunately, a member of his family is not doing real well right now, and he had to fly out of here. He actually got this message, right in the middle of the last hour of the show that we've been doing, so he troopered up and finished off the rest of it. But he's got to be with his family right now. Totally understandably. I'll try to take you through the rest of the show. We still got Brandon Shak Harris coming up in about 12 minutes or so. He should be going on his break in the 1500 Omaha 8 or better. So you just got me for a little while. Ross will chime in, do what he can.
I'm also here. I'll try.
Also here. You got knobs to fiddle with and buttons to push. You got to do all the stuff that I sure as hell don't know how to do. So
I'll try and read at the same time.
Don't worry about it. So we'll just jump back into some more not quite World Series wrap up in case you missed it. So in case you missed it, a player at the World Series of Poker left $7,000 in an Uber. Of course, Uber is in Las Vegas now. Providing a little bit of competition to the taxis. Also, Lyft is in there. I've actually seen some people with Lyft T-shirts hanging outside the Rio. Yeah. They've actually asked me like, "Hey, have you tried Lyft yet?" And I'm like, "Yeah, I have, but I have a car too because it's Las Vegas and you kind of need one." But Uber, of course, an official sponsor of the World Series of Poker. You've watched a lot of final tables. I'm sure you've seen the big logo on the felt.
Oh yeah,
they've got some signage, a bunch of signage in the parking lot, designated pickup area.
They've also got those gamer chairs at the feature table.
Oh, do they? I didn't even notice that.
You notice the like DX racer chairs? They're
oh okay.
Yeah. So, next time you're by the Thunderdome, look, they've got some crazy new chair sponsor.
I'll check that out the next time Matt Gravenstein makes a final table.
Well, hopefully it's you. And what is it in the 10K? Limit hold'em.
Yeah, maybe I'll hang out one of those comfy chairs on Saturday. Sorry, I bought this new microphone and it's great, but I keep accidentally hitting the mute button like an idiot. That's for that. Bust out there. But the world. But Uber gets some really good press this week. A poker player. Trying to find his name right here. Jacob Brundage left $7,000 in his little tote bag, which poker players often do, in the back of an Uber. According to the Las Vegas Review-Journal, he said he was freaking out. He realized he left the bag in the car, tried to call the driver through the app, but got disconnected. Of course, for those of you who haven't taken an Uber, basically what happens is you don't get to see your driver's phone number, but you can call him, right? You basically say call a driver and it'll automatically connect you to that driver. But the driver then said later on that you know, his phone has died, which is why he didn't answer. And then so what happened was that this guy, Jacob Brundage, contacted Uber on his phone, and actually he got to those people who are, I think, hanging outside of the Rio, or hanging out inside of the Rio. I guess they're allowed in there. And those people got in touch with the driver somehow. You know, he said, if you bring back the bag, we're going to give you $200. The driver got it back. And he also slipped $100 to the on-site team that helped him out. So, you know, it's kind of interesting, Ross. Like, if you leave $7,000 in a taxi, it's very different from leaving $7,000 in an Uber, right? Because Uber knows exactly what car you took. And so, you know, when you take a cab and you get out of a cab, you know, let's say you land at Las Vegas airport, you take a cab to whatever, the Aria.
Yeah.
You know, you're one of 800 zillion cabs that took a cab from the airport to the Aria. So if you left that $7,000 in the bag, I'm going to go ahead and say your equity is maybe like $500. You're not a big favorite to get that money back. But of course, with an Uber, like, you have a history. You know exactly who the last ride you took was. Uber knows exactly who the last person to ride with is. There's a very good chance you're getting that money back.
I mean, yeah. When I am traveling in different cities like Vegas, where you hear horror stories about like cab drivers, I like to I'll just snap a photo with my picture of like the cab ID that's on the back of the seat.
That's smart. I don't think most people do that, but that's very smart.
Yeah. But there is that, reminds me of that one story of the guy. I don't think they said who it was that left like $300,000 in the back of a cab in Vegas last year.
That too, yeah.
But that's a different amount of money. That's not like
that's like an I might get shot if I don't return.
Yeah, account. I might die.
Yeah. You get like a seven. You know, I don't know what I don't know Jacob Brundage looks like, but you know, if he's just like a you know, like a 27-year-old white dude wearing a hoodie, they might not be nearly as concerned as, you know, like, yeah, guy walks out wearing sunglasses and a vague accent or something like that, leaving $300 in the back of a truck. But hey, I mean, I think Uber's the best thing. I've said this before. Like, I think, you know, I take Ubers, I stay at Airbnbs. I just love the tech world that we live in, that we can, you know, this is just, for me, this is another reason why Uber's great.
Totally.
And Vancouver sucks for not having it.
In case
you missed it. Well, you know, we were talking a few weeks ago, of course, about the Poker Central contest. We were kind of making fun of it, where you had to pick the final table of the Super High Roller Bowl, and you had to do it in order of the finish to win $1 million. And of course, the odds against this are catastrophically high. There was a winner, but not, of course, of $1 million, because that was simply not going to happen. But Frank Versillo of West Babylon, New York, picked Rainier Kempe first, picked Fredder Holtz in second, and won the $10,000 top prize for, you know, getting the most points, I guess, according to their system in the High Roller Challenge. So good job, Frank, for doing that. Of course, yeah, I mean, that, you know, that was a much more reasonable thing, because you don't actually have to go pit the seven for seven, the sevenfecta.
Yeah.
Whatever you might call
especially
it.
Especially with somebody like, I've never even really heard of Rainier Kempe, so him winning really reduces the chances of anybody getting close, I think.
Right, and that's, I think, a smart thing to do, is you might pick someone like that. I mean, you might pick like, I mean, even a lot of people may even pick like the Bill Perkins, just trying to sort of, you know, get that idea of low percentage pick, kind of thing. In case you missed it, Howard Lederer showed up to play. I actually missed it. I'm reading off Adam's notes here. He showed up to play the $10,000 Nola Medusa 7. As we kind of speculated would happen this year. Of course, Howard's apology coming out right before the World Series of Poker, and you know, it was a bit of a surprise that last week that Chris Ferguson showed up out of the blue to play the dealer's 1500 dealer's choice that Chris Ferguson showed up and played, and then Howard Lederer, I guess after Chris didn't get you know, hit in the back of the knees with a baseball bat in the parking lot, decides to show up and play the 10K no limit deuce. And does that. Greg Merson apparently says the poker community should slow roll Howard on every hand every summer, which, I don't know, I feel like it kind of defeats the purpose, right?
Mm-hmm.
At some point, like, if everybody started slow rolling you, you would probably be like really suspicious anytime you turned your hand over.
Did you see Ferguson there at all?
Yes, I've seen him a couple times.
Was he wearing? He must not look like he used to.
He's dressed exactly the same.
He wears the cowboy hat still?
I don't know if he wears the hat, but he's still got the super long hair, and he still has the long leather jackets, whatever that style of
the
jacket
duster.
The duster. That's it. You got it. but he's still pretty much looking. You wouldn't think it was anyone else. He is definitely not in incognito.
Weird. If I was him, I would cut my hair and go to try and be as low key as possible.
Hair,
but
the goatee, get some contact lenses, just act like you're the witness protector. Even then, I almost think he's probably better off doing it the way he is, because he's going to run deep enough in tournaments where people are going to know, right? Because what happens is that when you bag on day one, of course, you write your chips in the bag.
Yeah.
You write your name on the bag, and then, the media gets access to all that information, right? So, on day two, what happens, for those of you who haven't played a World Series event, you come back with a card with a four-digit number on it. Well, usually it's a four-digit number anyway. It's A2, right? So, I won't be Terrence Chan. I'll just be 1008. Right, and so when my table breaks and I go to another table, people know that 1008 is Terrence Chan. So when some rookie reporter who doesn't know, who doesn't have any idea who I am, looks at that 1008 and, let's say I've got a ton of chips, or I busted Phil Ivey in a pot, or I did something notable, they don't have to walk up, do the thing where they walk up to me and say, "Excuse me, sir, can you tell me what your name is while you stack those chips?" They don't have to do that. So, Chris Ferguson couldn't be ignored, especially since, I'm sure he plans to make a final table, something like that, right?
Yeah.
Media is going to know who he is, so it's probably better off for him just to own it. That way he doesn't come across as thinking, come across with people thinking that, he's trying to get away with something. Did you happen to see this interview with Mike Sexton? That was, I don't remember, I think it might have been Poker Listings, I could be wrong, I can't remember exactly where I read it, but Mike Sexton, basically, to sum it up for you, and I'll try to find it as I'm talking, but Mike Sexton basically says that Chris Ferguson was actually one of the guys who was on the side of the players, trying to get things to happen. It was PokerListings.com, so this story is from June 9th, exactly 1 week ago. So he says that if Chris Ferguson told his side of the Full Tilt story, a lot of people would be a lot more sympathetic. He was, he goes on to say that Chris was one of the guys who didn't want to pay the shareholders and do all those kickbacks and all this kind of stuff, but that he was getting outvoted. I don't have to tell you that. I'm sure if Adam were here, he would very quickly say, "Well, but he still took the money. He still didn't give it back." Stuff. And I think that's all super valid. But I think it does go to show that there's a couple sides to the story.
Yeah, but he hasn't said anything. So
yep, and that still rankles a lot of people, including Adam. He talked about this last week. It definitely rankles Adam, and a lot of people, that he hasn't issued an apology. Daniel Negreanu, I think, wrote a full blog post about how sort of any person with decency, Daniel likes to sort of talk in these exaggerated plays, but he says any person with any shred of human decency or something like that would have made a statement or made an apology or something of that nature.
True.
Last item here before we get right into Brandon Shak Harris, who's about to go on break, as I said, in the 1500 Omaha 8 or better. Pierre Neuville. I'm so bad with French names. Here, the old dude who made the final table of. Thank you. That guy offers an even money bet that he can make the top 50 in the GPI next year. That's interesting. What do you think about that? So Pierre Neuville, 73 years old, making the top 50 in the GPI. So it's not insanely ambitious. He's not saying he can knock Timex and Steve O'Dwyer off the perch or something like that. But he's got to put in a lot of volumes, and he's got to do very well.
Yeah, the dude clearly has game. I mean, he came in... second, I believe, in the 1500 six max already this year. So
yeah.
He's feeling himself. He's feeling his oats. And I don't think it would be... Yeah, it's definitely within the realm of possibility.
Right, because, you have to consider that his bankroll is a lot better than the people he's competing against in the top 50, right? He's basically just got a bunch more money than those guys.
Yeah.
So he can play in all the high roller events. Obviously, you can't just make the top 50 in GPI purely on volume, because they'll chop off some of the bottom results. But cool to see him backing up. So he says he's willing to take $10,000 on any single bet and a total of $50,000 in bets on himself, which I don't really understand why he would want to break it up like that.
Just have more people owe him money if he wins.
Maybe he's diversifying just in case there's some guy who welters on
that. I mean, yeah, that's I don't know about that, but I hope that he gets action. I'd like to see him in there, you know, battling with the young guns.
Yeah, it's always really cool. Inspires a lot of hope for a lot of the old guys.
Yeah.
All right, that's going to do for In Case You Missed It, and let's see if we can't get Mr. Brandon Shak Harris on his quick break.
Okay.
All right on the line. I'm going to skip the usual flowering intros, but we've got Brandon Shak Harris for about the next 10 minutes. He's on the break in the 1500 Omaha 8 or better. Brandon, great to have you on. How is your World Series going so far?
Hey, thanks for having me on. So far, it's been pretty disappointing, but I'm winning a lot of hands in Omaha 8, and that is exciting because there haven't been much of that. I guess this series had a couple 3-day twos and 10Ks, one instead where I took my spots pretty poorly, dealer's choice, where I made a lot of big hands, and they didn't win, and then I was really short in the 10K horse, so I just couldn't run it up. Everything else I busted.
Right. And of course, Brandon, everybody remembers your epic 2014 where you established yourself as a breakout star, like busting right out of the gate with some major successes. Does it do you kind of think back on those things when you're at a time like you are now where things haven't quite gone your way, when you've gone deep and stuff but just run bad at or played bad at the wrong time?
Yeah, I mean it's weird because, I mean, that year, it was a really lucky year for me, obviously. I was really happy with how I played, but the end of the year, I came up short so many times and so many different things. I had 2 seconds and a third, so a chance for 3 bracelets, and then I had to travel to Australia to lose Player of the Year, George Danzer. So
right.
it was a good year, but it kind of ended kind of feeling a little bit like a fail for me. And I wanted to redeem myself in a lot of ways, kind of prove to myself that I can finish the job and also show everybody that it wasn't just, you know, one great year and blah, blah, blah. But right now it looks like it was one great year.
No, I've still lots of poker.
Still a lot of World Series 2016 to go. And every year I order, get some custom Converse shoes. And mine just came in yesterday.
Ooh.
And they got me to day 2. So I'm saying that everything that's happened so far is kind of leftovers from 2015. The shoes are in, so I'm feeling good about the rest of the series.
Brandon, I wanted to ask, pick up on something that you just mentioned was, you know, this idea of showing people that it wasn't just a one fluke year. Is that something that's important to you?
Not really. I mean, it's just something you think about. My ROI in all tournaments before 2012 was pretty good. I keep track of it year to year, and it was already a good winner, and I never actually looked after 2012. So I've done this for a living for a long time. So I feel pretty confident in myself, and also trying to prove yourself to a community, especially a poker community, is kind of a futile endeavor in itself.
Yeah, absolutely. And, like you said, you've been a successful cash game player for a really long time. I believe, have you been playing the Commerce lately? Is that right?
Yeah, Stephanie and I, my girlfriend, moved from Chicago to L.A. She wants to be closer to her family in Vegas. So now I'm a Commerce grinder with Jesse Martin. Graves has been there grinding the stud for days. And I guess it's paid off.
Absolutely, yeah.
He's my money winner this year. He's won me a little bit in swaps. It's going all right.
Talk
like
about
20 game mix.
Yeah, so to talk about the mix, what's in the mix, and you know, is it good most of the time? Are you crushing it? How's that going?
During LAPC, it was a bunch of different mixes, and a lot of weird stuff kind of happens at Commerce. Like generally, a mixed game will run seven-handed, but one person will come in. And the game will change from 300, 600 to 600, 1200. All the games will change, and they'll add an eighth seat that gets to bypass the rest of the list when, you know, a certain person shows up. So, and then when someone leaves, that seat will go away. So it's not like you're playing eight-handed for forever. It's just temporarily handed for that one player. Games change, stakes change, and everyone just goes along with it. After LAPC, we've pretty much been playing a 400, 800 for like 5 hours in the morning, two or three times a week. 20 games, and it's mostly guys who get along with each other, like no whining and no name calling, kind of a friendly thing.
Almost doesn't feel like the Commerce if people are being good to each other. It sounds pleasant. Sounds really good. You know, only got a couple minutes left on you. Give us a preview what your World Series schedule looks like for, you know, any fantasy sweaters who might be out there thinking and they got you in their team.
Sure. I'm still planning on. I think I have 20 more events still listed. I should still be playing the 50K unless I completely implode.
Are you playing all the 10Ks?
Except for the limit hold'em and the six max no limit. Yeah, I'll be there. Are you gonna play the? Are you gonna get there for the limit hold'em?
I will be there tomorrow. This time tomorrow. I'm glad I don't have to deal with you in that. I'm happy. That's one nice. Fewer person between me and the bracelet that I'm chasing. I'm glad not to,
come on,
to have to deal with.
I'm the dead money. I'm the dead money that you dream of.
So I seriously doubt that's the case.
But I will have the tie pads. I'll have more tie pads. So if you feel like you need to like bust out a few roundhouse kicks or whatever. I got your back.
Hell yeah! Let's do that. Let's give the people a show. I'll hold some kicks for you. You hold some kicks for me. You got a little size on me. So I think I'll do my best. But thanks so much for taking the time out of your break.
Thanks for having me.
Get everything you've done. Best of luck in the 1500 Omaha high low split, eight or better. Look forward to seeing you at. I'm sure we'll look forward to seeing you at some final tables by the end of the summer.
I hope we can catch up soon.
Definitely.
Thanks for the call.
Thank you.
Good luck, everybody.
That was Brandon Shak Harris, of course. You know, shorter than our usual interviews. We endeavored to get him. We endeavored to get Matt Gravenstein. We tried to get Ryan LaPlante. We want to get all these people, but of course,
that's what happens when all the poker players are playing poker and they're all slaves and they can't leave tournaments.
They are slaves. Joe McKean will tell you all about that. See, I'm skipping the 1K limit hold'em mega tonight, which I've heard is tremendously good value.
Oh, wow.
I'm a little disappointed. So I'm staying loyal to y'all, but I mean, I guess I'm the only one at the World Series of Poker who actually has a responsibility towards this show. So it's a good break.
Everybody appreciates it.
Yeah, would have loved to have some more time for sure with Brandon, a great guy to talk to. I often, you know, spend a dinner break or two with him, or like I said, maybe I'll just kick some Muay Thai pads.
Does he train MMA? Yeah.
He does Muay Thai, which of course Thailand style kickboxing, you know,
yeah.
With the knees and the elbows and the high kick. So when you're talking about Thai pads, for those that don't know, these are pads that are about, you know, maybe they're like 10 inches wide and maybe a foot and a half long, but they're like 3 inches thick of foam. So you could take a guy who is like an elite world-class kicker, and you can hold these pads and not, you know, get messed up. They're not like the little patty cake pads that boxers use. Mm-hmm. You know, not that boxers don't get hit hard, but they're boxers are fighting more for speed than power. Thai pads are more for power. So yeah, Brandon actually carries them in his bag, so he's not joking.
Oh, wow.
He's very serious about
good stress relief in between breaks. Speaking of poker players fighting, we've got to get out our next episode. It's been a bit of a hiatus.
We absolutely do. I've been writing some stuff up, and you're gonna have to walk me through how I record the stuff on Audacity so that I can send it to you.
Yeah.
We're going to have to just find a day where none of us are doing anything. I'm not playing poker, and we're not doing
and
this.
And I don't watch, like, 8 baseball games.
Oh, God, don't. you're watching 8 baseball games because, like, you've got, like, 3,000 riding on the last one or something like that.
You know,
just because Vanessa Selbst doesn't want to give 180-1 doesn't mean that Pinnacle Sports won't, right?
That's true. They would definitely take that action.
Should we jump right into the PokerStars Invitational this week?
Sure, let's do it.
Okay, so let me tell you about the PokerStars Invitational, the PokerCast Invitational for PokerStars listeners. That is, of course, is this the last one? Is this going to be the last
one? No, I think we have another week.
We've got one more.
But, I mean, since Adam's not here, I think I want to at least try and send in an extra one.
Okay. Yeah, definitely. So we told you last week on the show, of course, June 19th, this weekend, the event will be Super Stud. And the password is WSOP. I was informed that Superstud is actually available on the PokerStars client, which still surprises me. But you guys insist that it's true, so I won't hold you up to that lie.
We've had a lot of stud talk, or a lot of stud sweat so far this series.
Yeah, exactly. Stud is it's like the 7 card game is the event of the series between Jason Mercier and of course our buddy Grapes doing good. Yeah, it's no more flop games. Flop games are so 2000, early 2010s.
Yeah.
We're now all about stud games. But June 26th will be the final invitational for PokerCast listeners. So it looked like, I bet Adam picked this format. And do you know why Adam picked 5-card draw?
Not exactly.
Well, he said this on the show. He says because MJ hates 5-card draw.
Oh.
Never let him pick it.
Yeah, he would never, yeah.
Adam left a password here this week. I think it's only appropriate. The password is, and you might want to get out your pen for this one, TY for support stars. So I'll say that again. So TY as in thank you. The number 4 support stars. TY for support stars. Once again, that is June 26th, the Poker Stars Invitational for our listeners. 5-card draw.
Now, one thing about this is do we go limit, pot limit, or no limit?
Oh, that's absolutely.
I wonder if it's a possibility to do mixed limit 5-card draw.
Okay. Well, you inquire with that, you know, make it your sort of final request. You know, you're sort of like the inmate on death row looking for the last meal. You've got your last request. Maybe they'll accommodate that. But if not, I mean, 2 rounds of betting. I think pot limit is a good one. I think no limit is good. I think limit's kind of lame for 5-card draw.
Yeah.
Unless it's a triple, like five, like limit games are better for multiple street games, right? So like triple draw is way better limit than it is no limit. Triple draw no limit is stupid, mm-hmm. But triple draw limit is fun. As you know, so do what you can do. It'll be a surprise this week. Who cares? It's not like anybody out there is a 5-card draw specialist. But go ahead and get that extra added money, of course. 10 a.m. Pacific, 1 p.m. Eastern. I better not screw that up because I make fun of Adam literally. Right? So when we come back, the other side of the break, we will have some mailbag. We'll have some Ross report. Maybe we'll get into some 140 or less. We'll see what we can get in there. I got to do this thing solo. So I'll see how long until my voice and my brain fall apart and I got to quit on you guys. But keep it right here. This is the 2+2 PokerCast brought to you by the PokerStars VIP Cup. VIP Club. Keep it right here.
What's up, guys? My name is John Beaupre, and I'm the founder and lead instructor of PLOQuickPro.com. Now, we're the only site that has an entire suite of PLO courses designed by myself, a WSOP champion, and 3-time Supernova Elite PLO Crusher Alien Slayer. Over the past few years, we've successfully taught more than 1,000 players how to master the fundamentals, increase their win rate, and move up in stakes for good. So whether you're a small or micro stakes grinder trying to become a winner for the first time, or you're already a winning player looking to make more money and move up in stakes, and especially if you're a no limit player looking to make the transition to PLO, we've got the videos, PDFs, and tutorials to help you plug leaks and look at the game in a new way. To learn the guaranteed fastest ways to master the fundamentals, increase your win rate, and move up in stakes for good, visit www.plokwikpro.com/pokercast to get your very own personalized PLO curriculum. Or even better, if you'd like to reach out to me personally, shoot me an email at john@plokwikpro.com and I'll help you find the best courses to fit your game. Good luck.
I defend 8-9 offsuit versus a middle position open with Annie's, 40 big blinds deep. I flop a double gutter on queen 10-6 2 spades, and I like to check raise his c-bet as it's my worst possible draw in this situation, and his range contains more spades, thus making it a hand I'm going to free barrel on a lot of runouts. He folds to a check raise and I win the pot.
Team Pro Online's Mickey Moment Mori Peterson is a Supernova VIP. This is the 2 plus 2 PokerCast presented by the PokerStars VIP Club.
Hi guys, it's Mike from ProfessionalPoker.com and the 2 plus 2 store with some great news for our PokerStars players. You can now use your frequent player points to purchase gift cards available from ProfessionalPoker.com. These same cards will also work at the 2 plus 2 store. The gift cards come in increments of $25 and $50, and you can apply multiple gift cards per order. Now you can get the books, videos, and ebooks from all the major publishers using just your FPPs. So check out the gift card section of the PokerStars FPP store and pick up the poker training material you've had your eye on for a while at the 2 plus 2 store and ProfessionalPoker.com.
Welcome back to the 2 plus 2 PokerCast, brought to you by the PokerStars VIP Club. I am Terrence Chen, as mentioned before. Adam's not able to join us for the third part of this show, but you know what is able to join us, Ross? Our lovely, lovely listeners and the mailbag.
And now...
That right there is the mail. Now let's talk about the mail. Can we talk about the mail, please, Malcolm? I'm dying to talk about the mail with you all day, okay?
Mailbag. Email number
one. I do have one voicemail. The quality was a little iffy, but we'll see if you can hear it here.
I'll do my best.
Hi, this is Zach. I'm calling from Detroit. I have a question about a 125 premium PLO game. So, me, the hero, raised 20 over a limb with ace, queen, four, suited to the ace. I get one caller in position. The blinds call and the limper call, so we're seeing the flop five ways. And the flop is king, nine, deuce, rainbow. And it's three checks to me. The effective stacks are approximately 700 with every player. Everyone besides one of the blinds was covered. The blinds is one kind of bad regular, one all-right pro who's nearly an limit player, a really bad player that limped, really loose, and a similar player profile for the guy in position. I think most of these players are going to lead out their like two pair, especially their top two pair combos. So are we ever betting here for value and protection? Thank you. Big fan of the show. Looking forward to hearing what PLO experts have to say. Thanks.
All right. So let's recap this hand real quick from Zach in Detroit. Make sure I got it right. He's playing 1-2-5 PLO. I don't recall if he said how much he has on the table or what the other guys have.
Yeah,
on the table.
I don't know that either. But we can just, okay. We can talk about different stack depth.
Sure. Yeah, and we can assume it's something reasonable for a cash game. And the hand he was dealt ace queen four with one suit, I believe. And there was a limper to him, and I believe he raises it. And both blinds call and the limper calls. Do I have about that right?
It went five ways to the flop.
Okay, so five ways to the flop, which is king nine deuce. Was there a flush draw on that one? I'm not sure. I think it was just king nine deuce rainbow, I'm guessing.
I'm not sure
if I caught that. So yeah. I guess the question largely is, are we going to bet aces unimproved five ways? And I think on a reasonably dry flop like this, and I definitely wish I had Adam and John to help. I'm inclined to bet this way on a dry flop. A lot of the times you will have kings. A lot of times you'll have ace king with side cards. You're not super thrilled with this flop, but it's also not the worst flop. I think a lot of the times as a pre-flop aggressor, you pick it up as long as you're a favorite against a lot of the hands that will still call you. You would like to get heads up, ideally, if somebody's going to play against one of the people you have position on. It really sucks when one of the people behind you calls, but it sounded like he has position on most of the players in the hand. Your thoughts?
Yeah. I think that once it's check two, unless you have I guess if you were super deep, there's like an awkward stack depth. Maybe if you had if the SPR was 5-1 and you could get check raise and just ruined, that would be awkward and you might want to check back. But if it's smaller than 2-1, I would probably just bet, get it all in.
And if it's bigger, you can bet fold.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Or bet, and then they call, and then you kind of see what happens on the turn to figure it out. I agree. Yeah, the times where you wouldn't want to bet is sort of like you said there, where your SPR is sort of in the smallish to medium range, where if somebody check raises you and there's some money behind, that's a really rough spot because they could have you completely smashed because they could have a set.
Yeah.
More likely than that, they might have something like king, queen, jack, 10, which is actually a favorite over your hand, but isn't actually winning at the moment. It's a hand where you would probably have close to enough equity to call. Lots of combo draws, even straight draws combo, queen, jack, all the queen, jack, 10, queen, jack, 10, 9, of course, is a pair and a rat and an inside wrap. All these kind of things can put you in a very difficult spot. If there's a flush draw on the flop, even more so, where you're in this sort of guessing game where you think, well, I might have anywhere between 40% and 60%, or I might just be smashed by a set. And then if that's the case, I might have 10% or something like that, with my backdoor straight draw and my set redraw and that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
It really depends on the stack size. So that's sort of my thought on it. But most of the time, if you're deep, stabbing and reevaluating seems fine. And if you're shallow, betting and getting it in is fine. I definitely, of course, even if you're shallow, I probably wouldn't want to get it in three ways. I would be really hesitant about that.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe I'm nitty.
Yeah, I wouldn't want to get it in if I got check raise. There are also some decent cards on the turn. He has the backdoor wheel draw, so the little cards are kind of nice.
Yep, and that's true too. And probably, we don't know the flush draw situation, but probably a good chance he picks up a backdoor flush draw, given that he had a suit. So if he flopped one of his suit, there's a decent chance he picks up a backdoor flush draw on the turn.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
Email number 2.
Gregory writes, "What's going on, Adam, Terrence, and Ross? My name is Gregory, and I've been listening to the Pokercast since around 2008. Well, thanks for hanging out with us for all those years." Gregory goes on to say he lives in Pasadena, California. He works as a rocket scientist during the day. literally a rocket scientist. I can only imagine what his question is going to be. I played a ton online and live back in college. Only have the time now to play recreationally. I won a seat to a $1,500 World Series event of my choice through an online poker league, so I figured I should get some live practice in. And he would like our thoughts on the following hand. This is from a $150 buy-in MTT at the Commerce, and he's playing 400, 800 with a 100 ante. The effective stacks in this hand will be 24,000. See, this is how you write a strategy question. Give me all the relevant information. Under the gun plus one,
Wouldn't expect anything less from a real rocket scientist.
Exactly. Like if you screw stuff up, and you know if you forget, like, oh yeah, what kind of screws did you use on on panel number 4 or whatever? And you're like, oh, I don't know. Then the thing just blows up, and now you're on CNN for the next 3 weeks as the idiot who screwed up the rocket. No, that's not how Gregory rolls. Anyway, so it's under the gun plus one, who's. Not terribly active, not terribly tight, raises to 3,000 and folds him in the big blind with ace-king suited. He thinks for a while, shoves for the whole 24,000 and gets called by aces. GG. He goes on to say, I played a bunch of sit-and-goes back in the online days. I usually make sure I have at least two of the following to shove. Number one, risk. Not risking that much considering we're still early in the tournament. Two, reward. Winning the pot would increase my stack by 22%. Three, fold equity, which obviously you have. Four, hand strength, check. I think my shove was okay since I had all of the above four checked, although I'm second-guessing myself, and I think I may have taken too high variance of a line because I have a pretty good stack that I could use to chip up. Anyways, thank you for providing the excellent material. Greg, this is definitely an interesting spot, 30 big blinds deep. I don't hate the way you played the hand. It is often a little bit unbalanced because a lot of the times – people will know you have exactly a hand like ace-king when you take a line like this, when you've got an early position raise and it falls back to you in the big blind. So anytime you're three betting from the big blind against an early position raise, you're signaling a lot of strength, right? Because basically if you have any sort of reasonable hand here, that's not a monster, you're going to be calling. In fact, I've definitely even seen people call with aces and kings in this spot just because what happens when you re-raise is that your range is so unbalanced. It's so skewed towards aces, kings, queens, maybe jacks, ace, queen suited, maybe, but probably not even, and then like a couple of bluffs sprinkled in. So I think the more standard line on this would just be call. I know that sounds really weird with ace, king suited. With antes, and so, but I think that's how most professionals would play it. Whether that's correct or not, that's another story. But it's not absolutely terrible to shove the 30 big blinds with ace king suited, because one of the interesting things is, and David Sklansky brought this up way back in the day when he first started writing about tournament strategy, was even if you told people that you have ace king suited here, or that you have these kind of hands a lot, like if you have ace king suited, aces, kings, and queens, there's not much they can do to defend it, right? They can only play correctly by folding their big hands, and there's not too much to do about it. But Ross, do you have any thoughts on sort of a weird spot like this?
Well, yeah, the thing is, I think in like a 10K you'd want to be balanced here, but in the 150 daily at the Commerce, I don't think there's any real reason for balance. And if somebody, I guess it depends who you're playing against. If you think the guy's just not going to be able to fold like ace 10 off or something, then Right. Then it's a good shove, I suppose. It's hard to be totally wrong shoving ace king suited, but
that's a good point. I mean, there are people who will just call you with ace queen and ace jack and
or
stuff.
Just like pocket eights, or like, I mean, you're gonna have to win flips to win the tournament. Maybe it's
right. Yeah. I mean, actually, here's the thing. So if you shove and the guy does have pocket eights and he folds, that's actually a very big win for you, right? Because you're out of position on this hand. You know, you need to improve to beat him. He's going to bet most non-ace, non-king flops. So, you know, it's not necessarily, that's why shoving pre-flop is actually not that bad. You know, specifically because you can make those small pairs fold. I mean, hell, tens might fold because he's scared you have jacks. Mm-hmm. That kind of thing. Those kind of things will happen in these. It's definitely an interesting hand. I think the shove was okay. I would probably lean towards calling, especially if the tournament is pretty soft. And not only that, like you're sort of playing this thing to get some experience. I think it's different. So here's an interesting one, actually, mm-hmm. yesterday, Ross. I was playing the 6-max 3K, and I had a very tough table. On one of my last hands, Jonathan Duhamel opens the pot, and I don't remember exactly what blinds we were playing. I think maybe 600, 1200. So he opens the pot to like 3,000, and it's called by, I think, the button, who's also a good player. And I'm in the big blind, and I actually had about 20 big blinds. So let's call it about like 24, 26,000 like that. And I probably should have shoved, but instead I called, ended up flopping an ace and losing to Duhamel's river two pair. And so that sounds like a bad beat story, but I actually feel like I played this wrong. I maybe could have just shoved preflop, considering I'm up against two good players out of position against both of them.
Yeah.
I think that's a really good spot to actually make the big overbet shove. But of course, I'm only shoving 20 big blinds, and I'm shoving at a six max table against somebody who's probably opening fairly light, again, because it's six-handed. So I think that's a very different spot. So, whether or not I think the hand is played perfectly, I like Gregory's thought process on this. I think you're a solid favorite in your $1,500 limit event.
That's for sure.
Email number 3.
Tom from Virginia writes, it's a quick one. He says he's been listening for years and he loves the Boston segments during NCAA tourney time. I wonder if that includes the politics. It was great seeing him and learning more about him. A must watch. I can only assume that he is referring to the Best of It documentary. You've seen that, right?
I did. I watched it the other week. I enjoyed it immensely.
Yeah, I haven't seen it. I should get on that. Is it on Netflix or what did you watch it on?
On iTunes, you can rent it for like $4.99.
Okay.
So you can just stream it off of either on your computer or Apple TV or whatever. It's funny. Sports bettors are different than poker players, I think. It's generally like an older crowd.
Of course, yeah.
And there's some good storylines in that documentary. I would recommend it.
Cool.
Email number 004. Hit my
Jones up on the low. Big Brett writes, hey fellas, he is 8,119.65 kilometers from Kells. Thank you for the precision. He says he just got back from playing the Colossus for the second time. The cash games weren't as crowded during the Colossus as they were last year. The addition of some tables to existing rooms seemed to spread out the crowds, and the lower number for the tournament also helped in that way. No 10-hour waits for 1-2 and 2-5 this year. That's good to hear. Good trip report for Brett for anybody who's looking to come down to the World Series on the weekend. I think that, I mean, obviously the Colossus, it only happens once, but the weekend's always crowded, so it's good to know for those who might want to try to grind some small stakes, no limit cash, that hopefully you'll be able to get in the game. Of course, another good thing to do, always check the Bravo Poker app that you can get for iOS and Android, and that'll tell you sort of the status of the waitlist. So,
yeah, for sure. I feel like they prepared a little bit, kind of knowing this year.
Yeah, definitely. And like Brett said, and like we talked about last week, the Colossus probably underdid the numbers that they were expecting, so they probably had a few extra hands and tables on deck. He wants to run a hand from the Colossus by us. He plays the following hand against Alan Cunningham, who was seated on his right. He's got about 4,000 chips at 150-300 with a 25 ante. It gets folded to Alan in the small blind, and he completes. His thought is, why didn't he just raise me off my hand? I look down at Jack 4 of clubs and check. The flop comes down. Queen of hearts, 4 of clocks. Oh, excuse me. That's not a real hand. Queen of hearts, 4 of hearts, deuce of diamonds. Brett flops second pair and a jack kicker with no backdoor flush draw. Alan bets 300 into the 800 pot, playing eight-handed. He calls. He's got a pair, and he figures Alan's going to bet the flop a lot.
Yeah, it's hard to make a pair.
It's hard to make a pair, so I definitely agree with the call. The turn is the five of hearts, so that completes some draws, obviously. The front door flush draw gets in there, and some straight draws get there, the ace three and the 3-6. Puts, of course, another overcard to his pair, so now he's demoted to the third pair, and Alan bets 700. And Brett describes, I freeze, I count out the chips, and almost pull the trigger and shove, but I can't. I folded. I want some feedback. And hoping for another 400 shows. 400 shows. How many years of that would be? That's about seven years.
Yeah.
And considering we take a couple of weeks off. We're drawing live. We got a shot at this thing. Maybe we'll do another 400. Okay, so we got an effective starting stack of 4,000. And we've got, doing some quick math here. So we've got a pot size of about, okay, going into the turn, we've got a pot of about 1,400. And Alan's betting half the pot. Do we want to shove for the last couple thousand? I think that would probably be the wrong play. I don't know that folding is the right play. I think it's a choice between calling as Yeah, I would think it's calling. I don't think raising is correct here. You are basically, it's going to be very hard for you to fold out better hands. I think Alan is smart enough that he won't bet any hands that he's not willing to call with that aren't bluffs. So in other words, if he's got a queen, he might play it like this, but he's going to call your raise. He's not folding a queen. If he's got a flush, well, duh. If he's got a straight, duh. He might have something like 4 or 5, turn 2 pair, and he would be happy about calling the shove, but he would. So I think most of the time, if you raise, you're only raising out the pure, complete air bluffs. Maybe something like a 7-8 is a hand that you could get out where he's semi-bluff, where he was just stabbing randomly on the flop, and he picked up a semi-bluff on the turn. I think an important thing is not to be intimidated by guys like this, but you know, just kind of remember that they don't necessarily try to bully you at every opportunity. I think folding is not too bad. I would probably have preferred calling. I think it's a little weak. The thing is, you do have position on this hand. If he checks on the river, you're obviously going to check unimproved. And if he bets out, most of the time, I think you're going to fold on this river unimproved because he is representing a lot of strength. One of the things that I used to, you know, worry about when I was younger in my poker career was, you know, a big name would sit down at my table and I always think they're going to run me over. And it just turns out that most of the time they're not trying to do that. Most of the time they're just trying to play their hand. So, yeah, interesting hand, but, you know, don't hate the fold. Probably would have preferred to call it myself.
Okay.
Email number. It's number
5. For number 5, John writes us, "Hey guys, just writing to the show in hopes of getting some of that famous podcast run good for my upcoming trip to the World Series of Poker." Doesn't tell us what event he's going to play, but we'll see. So he's got a would you rather. So would you rather never fly first class again for the rest of your life or never eat bacon again for the rest of your life? Keep up the good work. Hope you find a new sponsor to keep the show running. Ross, how many times have you flown first class in your life?
I've flown business class one time.
Was it on one of those nice 777s?
It was on Cathay. Vancouver. Okay,
so that was
Vancouver to New York.
So you hit the button and it reclines completely. Fine.
Oh yeah.
Lie down. Oh, so you know the experience. I mean, that's a business class. It's pretty darn close to a legit international level first class.
Yeah.
Would you rather never get to experience that or never?
I mean, yeah, I'd definitely go with bacon. I don't know. I don't think I'm going to be flying as much as I need to eat bacon.
Yeah, so you're going to keep bacon. I think most of us.
Bacon is like it's a daily thing. How often do you take? I mean, you fly more than I do, but it's still not that many days a year.
Yeah, I mean, you know, if I'm Richard Brody, maybe it's a tougher situation. You know, the man likes his first class. I'm sure a lot of people do too. Maybe like someone like Daniel Negreanu. Maybe if you were like, I could see it if like, say you like lived in Vancouver and you played like a full EPT schedule or something like that. You know, you were just like flying all the damn time. But bacon's a hard
one. Well, Daniel's made his choice.
Well, yeah, I guess he has. Daniel is definitely, this is an easy one for Daniel in the other direction. But yeah, I don't even eat like a ton of bacon anymore, but I'm still choosing bacon.
Email number
6.
D. Ross, is he related to you?
D. Ross? I don't think so.
No, okay. We'll find out. I guess you might have mentioned it. He says, "Hey guys, got a decent how much would it take proposal?" Oh boy. This is going to be some more fear factor stuff, right? Two parts. How much would it take for you to vote for Trump? Everyone would know you did, no hiding. Second part. How much would it take for you to vote for Trump, but this time you're the deciding vote? Again, no hiding or secrecy, everyone you'd know. For me, it wouldn't take very much to – my vote is definitely for sale. I'm not American, so it's not literally for sale. And I don't break the law, so it's not literally for sale. But you know what I mean. I mean, I don't think the fact is that virtually no election is settled by one vote anyway. But so that's why the second part is interesting. So basically, how much would it take for me – to decide that Donald Trump is the president rather than Hillary Clinton? I mean, I'm not a big Hillary Clinton fan either, so I'm not sure that it would be a huge money. It's the Trump thing is almost at this point like, you know, your friends would be mad at you more than anything, because honestly, like, I think it's two shitty choices, to be perfectly honest.
Yeah.
I don't like to get into the politics stuff on this show, but I mean, I think Hillary's kind of a shitty you know, presidential candidate too. I mean, she's done a lot of really bad shit.
Yeah, they both seem to have. That's why.
And Trump's a fucking moron. Like, you know, Hillary doesn't scare me. Like, so to me, it's always scary because like guys like Obama and Hillary, you know, I think they're just as bad, but they're smart. And I'd rather take the dumb guy who's bad rather than the smart guy. Times, you know,
I worry about the environment though, because Trump's all like, I'm gonna revive the coal industry, and there's a whole bunch of stuff that can go wrong on both sides. But
yeah.
So I think I would play both sides. I want to see how much money I could get on both sides, and then just fire on whatever I could get paid more for.
Yeah, but yeah, if he's saying only the Trump side, so I mean, yeah, I mean, I guess because well, here's the thing, like. They spend so much money on elections, right? If you actually went to the highest bidder and you were the deciding vote somehow, like you would, the winning bid would be like $500,000 or something. Like it would be just an obscene amount of money.
Right? Oh yeah, it would be like, so much.
But that's obviously not the minimum. So how much would it take is obviously asking you the minimum.
Oh, the minimum.
Right. Would you do 500?
Oh, five. No, I mean, it's pretty big decision. I think.
Yeah.
I think the. I think I would be like, if I had like 60,000 in cash in front of me, that would probably sway me.
It'd be hard to say no. Yeah, I was thinking about it. I was thinking about 100. You know.
Yeah.
But I said, it doesn't hurt me that much because I don't like Hillary that much either. So I mean, like if the choice was between like Trump and like somebody I really believed in. Then we're talking about like 7-8 figures, right? Like somebody that I thought was like, man, this is what the United States, the most powerful nation in the world, like this is a good leader who's going to do honest, good shit, and like really, you know, he's going to like fix the economy, and he's going to take all the right positions on terrorism and international affairs and all this kind of stuff. But I don't see that happening in my lifetime. I don't see that guy showing up and getting a nomination from either party.
Right. All right. Was that 5 or 6?
Oh. I think that was 6.
Okay.
I think we're on 7.
Email number
7.
Bo writes, I want to get your opinion on starting to play mixed games. I primarily play mid-stakes, no-limit, and PLO cash. Looking to get started in mixed games. I'd rather not sit at my local game and lose a couple thousand learning the game. I was wondering if you guys had any recommendations on books to lay out the rules and basic strategy of mixed games. Thanks. This is an interesting one because a lot of the mixed games, they don't have too much literature, right? So, you know, you've got the old the 2+2 books are, you know, hold up substantially well. The high-low split books, the 7-card stud books, you know, those games, those show up well. I'm assuming that Bo's in the U.S. He doesn't have the opportunity to necessarily play low stakes online. If you do, that's by far the best play. Jump in the 5-cent, 10-cent on stars and jump in that 8 game. That's unquestionably the best way. Twitch, of course, great way to do that.
Yeah.
I think
it's not the easiest to find a mixed game stream, though.
It's not, but you can. I mean, I know Chris George was doing a few.
Right.
Yeah, do you know who else is on Twitch? I mean, you're much more of a Twitch guy than me. Do you know who else is streaming the mixed games?
Well, Somerville does. Not every day, but he does it. And Negreanu did it when he streamed. And that's pretty much it that I can think of. I'm sure there's some other random people. I've stumbled across people streaming like really low stakes on Bovada. So Americans can play. I mean, if you wanted to throw like $30, whatever, on Bovada, and you know, not be too worried about having to get that money back, I'm sure that's worth playing.
Yep. Yeah, definitely. The World Series of Poker final tables, of course. Great commentary. I've been learning a lot.
Watching
some of the, you know, I'll watch if it's a game I don't understand very well. I'm definitely going to watch with the commentary and the whole cards up. Great resource to learn. I mean, Bo, in your case, you know, it looks like he's learning the basics. So I think most of the books, even the ones that are published like 10, 15 years ago, still very relevant to understanding. I mean, in a game like Stud, for example, just being aware of how up cards affect things, you know. Mixed games, Super System 2, of course, had some good stuff. Daniel's triple draw section was excellent in Super System 2. So there's a few starts on there. Bo, hopefully you can get in there. Let's do one more email.
Okay.
Email number.
Adam says, well, not our Adam, but Adam might get Adam's take on this
hey
next week. maybe it's 2008, Adam. greetings. Who would you
everybody
put on your
Adam
poker?
From bigpoker.ca.
It's not that Adam from bigpoker.ca.
It might be.
Who would you put on? Yeah, maybe he's just sending an email to himself. He's seeing the box. Who would you put on your poker Mount Rushmore and why? Adam says he would put Amarillo Slim, Ted Forrest, Sammy Farha, not Chris Moneymaker, and Johnny Moss. Now I know it's not our Adam.
Yeah.
I know that's not Adam's list. Adam would not have Amarillo Slim on there, and neither would I, because the man was a cheat. And you could say, yeah, a lot of people were cheats back in those days, but he was kind of an angle shooter up until his death. So, you know, not the most savory of characters, to be perfectly honest. I don't have a very – I mean – you know, you're not supposed to speak ill of the dead and all that stuff, but I do not have an opinion. I do not have a strong opinion of Amarillo Slim. Ted Forrest, obviously another story. Ted Forrest has always been a classy guy. Stood this test of time for a long time. I got no problem with that one. Sammy Farah, not really sure why that would make a list. I mean, yeah, he's probably the most famous second place finisher in World Series main event history. Is he? Do you think he's the most famous second player?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, yeah. I like to think he cemented his place in my heart from the ridiculous hands on high stakes poker.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, the many like million or half million dollar pots with like no pair.
Yeah, and Johnny Moss. Yeah, I'd say it's a stone lock. I have to get Stu Unger in there, I would imagine. Mm-hmm. You know, three main event titles and an absolute legend, and on there, I think he boots off a bunch of people on the spot. Make an argument for you know, in the modern generation, Phil Ivey and Daniel Negreanu. I think both of these guys, when we kind of look back at things and do the assessment, they're going to be both considered to. I think especially Daniel. I think actually, if you want to talk about enduring star power, I'm actually going to give the Lifetime Achievement Award to Daniel over Phil at this point. Not as many bracelets.
Yeah, where is Phil?
What's that?
Where is Phil? He's disappeared.
Yeah, I haven't seen him.
He's on your fantasy team.
Yeah, thanks for the needle. you know, it's always worth a shot to have Phil on the fantasy team. It wasn't expensive. But I think Daniel Negreanu has to get there for everything that he's sort of done for poker to the stage, and of course his accomplishments, Daniel. So yeah, I think I do have Chris Moneymaker in there. If I don't have Chris Moneymaker, then Isai Scheinberg is there.
Right.
Johnny Moss, definitely no arguments there. So those are some of my short list. Do you got any others that I might have missed?
No, I think those are all good. No, I can't come up with anybody that's better than that.
All right, then let's hit up 140 or less then.
Okay.
140 characters, that's it. I love hashtags. I love all of them.
Terrence Chan
needs more than 140 characters to express himself.
140 or less.
Oh, I do have somebody.
Yeah?
Doug Lee.
Oh, come on. Did you know, by the way, my girlfriend used to rent an apartment from Doug Lee?
I could believe that.
Is that the most random thing that you've ever heard?
Isn't he
used to be my girlfriend's landlord?
He's Canadian. I've heard that in the 2+2 thread. I've heard that he talks at the table about how much real estate he owns. So
story checks out.
Yeah.
No, and so she could verify this. So this isn't even like it's not even a brag. Like both, you know, this is checked out. So all right, Doug Lee. He at least makes the NVG Mount Rushmore.
Definitely.
There's no question. He's a stone lock.
Oh, what would be? Yeah, that would be Doug Lee,
Randy Hobaker.
Yeah, Randy Hobaker, Brian Hastings.
Yeah, yeah, Brian Hastings definitely gets in there. Yeah.
Phil Hellmuth maybe. Anyways, all right.
Seriously serious.
Yeah, definitely.
All right. You threw up the 140 or less this week, it looks like, so I'll let you read them off.
All right. Chris Kludnicki at Sloppy Kid says, everyone who waits... Sorry?
Sloppy Claude.
What did I say?
You said Sloppy Kid.
Oh, Sloppy Claude. Yeah. Dyslexic. Everyone who waits till it's on them to look at their hand, I hate you.
I agree.
I do,
right?
Too.
Right there with you. I'm going to try to find that tweet and retweet that one.
It's the worst. It's like, and it's even worse when somebody does it in a live 1-2 no limit game. It's like, dude,
yeah. Stop. I mean, I was playing, like I said, I was playing the 3K6 max, and I think we had three of these guys at our table.
Oh yeah.
Super. It was the slowest 6 max table ever.
Oh, that's so tilting. All right. Kathy Liebert said, at PokerCat, a while back, I made a prop bet with Jason Mercier. The bet was that he couldn't wear any black at the World Series of Poker. When Jason wanted out of the bet, I let him out.
That's funny.
Well, I like the idea of the bet, because Jason
likes wearing black.
He does wear quite a bit of black. So I guess the more interesting part is she's kind of commenting on letting Jason not letting Vanessa out of the bet.
It's obviously kind of it sounds like it's a little bit tongue in cheek, because I doubt their bet is for like six figures or seven figures or anything like that. But kind of a fun one. But I wonder if Kathy could go World Series without wearing purple.
True. I mean I'm still torn about that, because I think it's like the chances are so much worse than 180-1 for Jason to win that bracelet. It was a sweat last night when he got so close, but I don't know. It seems like even if he got that one, it's still so hard to win a third.
I absolutely agree. Yeah, like I said, still somewhere between 5-1, 6-1,
yeah,
something like that. Quick Jason Mercier update, still in third place.
Wow.
Still in third place, 24 remaining.
Wow. All right. And then somebody named Vincent, I believe he must be a poker player, but somebody retweeted this. It said, first big score of the summer, and it's a 20 on the sidewalk.
This is Jay Carver's boyfriend.
Oh, okay.
Is that Vincent? Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's that, because his first. That's Jason Somerville's boyfriend, Vincent.
Oh wow!
They live together.
You set it off. Some people are going to be trying to find out who Vincent is now.
There you go.
That's funny, but yeah, I can relate. I haven't had a great World Series either, and I'm not even there.
You find a 20 on the sidewalk in Vancouver?
No, but
there's still many weeks left.
This is true. This is true. I lost my place.
Barry Hutter, that's the one we're at.
Yes.
I got you.
Okay.
Barry Hutter, Barry underscore Hutter, says he's playing 3K 6 max today. Didn't sleep much. Ate like shit. Didn't work out. Drinking coffee with sugar in it. # the recipe. I feel like it's appropriate I read that one out, because I'm always beating the drum for sleeping well.
Right.
And eating well.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, you know.
And you don't put sugar in your coffee.
I don't put sugar in my coffee. I like my coffee blacker than midnight at the bottom of an oil well, and with bitter and angry.
Do you drink milk?
I don't. I mean, you know, I don't like milk in my coffee that much. I don't normally drink milk. I'll put my coconut milk in smoothies and stuff like that.
Right.
I like my coffee black. I like my coffee like angry at me. You know, I want, you know, it's 8 a.m. You know, I'm stumbling out of the room.
Yeah.
You know, boy, I'm putting on the pot, and you know, I wanted to say, like, hey, get your shit together. You got stuff to do today. All right, then. So that does it for 140 or less. So I think the traditional way to finish this up, as we do on this here poker show, let's get into the Ross report.
Okay.
Good old Roscoe. Sure glad he's all right.
Hey, boy, you gotta pick your spots. Good, you gotta make hay while the sun shines. Hey, good, you dipstick.
It's time for a Roscoe report.
Okay. The PLO Quick Pro concept of the week, and I might have to spread this out over a couple of weeks because I need to figure this out, is making river calls.
Ah.
Yeah.
That's my specialty. I'm really good at calling on the river. Like, I do it all the time.
Yeah.
It's really simple. You just hit the button in the middle. It's easy.
It is the middle.
Why does John even have a segment on this?
Okay. So in this hand, I'm in middle position. I have a little bit more than 100 big blinds. And I'm dealt the ace, queen, deuce, ace, or ace, ace, queen, deuce, with one suit, ace, queen of clubs. It's folded to me. I raised to 3.5x, 175. the cutoff calls, the button calls. So I'm out of position, going to a 10-queen-3 flop with $6 in it. I lead this flop for like 66%, I believe, is my button. And I get raised by the cutoff. And the button folds. So what do you think about this spot?
Yeah, I think this is a tough spot because, you know, in general, you really hate to call with medium strength hands when there's, you know, a couple pot size bets behind. Yeah, on the other hand, it's folding seems really tough too. So, I mean, yeah, I guess calling is probably right. But this is this kind of spot where I'm not super comfortable with either, because I think if you call too much, you end up bleeding in the long run when you're out of position and you know, you're just going to check fold the turn a lot. I mean, I guess what are the turn cards that we're hoping for here is the question. So yeah. A queen would be fine. An ace would be fine.
An ace completes the most obvious straight draw.
It does, but it gives us a redraw, I guess. So yeah. I mean, yeah, there's not a lot of great turn cards, which is kind of why like I feel this is a really tough spot. I don't know the answer. Like folding seems wimpy, but it might not even be wrong.
Yeah. So I do call, and I turn the nut straight blocker on the jack of spades turn card. So
now you've got to fire it. Yeah.
So I fire about 2/3 of the pot.
I'll go ahead and say it's not the nut straight blocker. It's one of the nut straight blockers, because you could also have two kings.
This is true. Yeah. So I lead out and I get called. And on the river, the pot is 62. I don't have much left behind, and I river top set on the worst card in the deck, what seems to be like the most draw completing card in the deck that brings in the backdoor flush and the nut straight.
Okay, so let's recap the board again. So once again, we had a flop of queen of spades, 10 of diamonds, 3 of hearts. The jack of spades came in on the turn, and the ace of spades came in on the river. So we've got a river that looks like ace, queen, jack, 10, 3, with 3 spades on it. You have precisely 0 spades in your hand, but you do have 2 bullets for top set. So any king and any Broadway card makes a straight, and of course any 2 spades makes a flush. So like you said, top set, but not exactly thrilled about it.
Mm-hmm. So I check, and he goes all in.
He sets you all in.
Now I'm getting
$28 to you.
Yeah.
There's $62 in the pot.
Plus the other $30.
Yeah, right, and you're overall on this call, you're getting about a little better, maybe 3.5 to 1, something like that. Huh. That's a real ugly one, because like you said, it is the most draw completing board. He did also call on the turn, which makes it, I think, a little bit more likely that he would have spades, and you of course don't have zero spades in your hand.
Yeah.
The fact that it's such a like that it's kind of a small bet leans me towards a call. I think definitely if there's more money behind, I think, you know, folding is definitely the play, because he would have been more likely to call with the implied odds of a spade draw. The fact that it's an ace of spades, most people don't chase necessarily without nut flush draws, but the fact is he probably already had a straight on the turn, so he might have had like something like king nine for the straight, or he might have had some sort of three pair hand or two pair hand with a
but
king.
But I think that he usually checks back his unimproved non-nut straights for sure.
Agreed, yeah. So you probably do bluff catch a lot, so I think I'm okay with a call for the stack size.
Yeah, he ended up making the flush and the straight on the river along with his set. He had king 10-10-7. So if the river was not... I mean, I am bluff catching a lot of sets and two pairs that are turned into bluffs.
Right.
And yeah, on this river.
Right. The problem is that those sets and two pairs tend to be connected with other things that,
I know.
That make these hands. So yeah. That's exactly what happened here. I mean, I think obviously he played the hand very reasonably, you know, flopping second set and then turning, you know, sort of a lot of draws. He's not sure which one he wants to hit, but he ends up hitting it.
Yeah. Yeah. And I guess kudos to him for going for the semi-thin. Oh, no, he had the second nuts. Yeah,
he had second nuts on the flop. Yeah. He played it totally reasonably.
Okay. All right. In the second hand, I am under the gun with 100 big blinds. I am dealt the 3-4 or the 7-5-4-3 double suited. That's Joe Ingram's favorite hand, and I raise under the gun. You know, I gotta add this one to my under the gun range, Terrence.
I was gonna say, do you have the clip handy?
Oh, yeah. I've got it here.
No, you're trying
under
to.
Under the gun, you don't raise. You limp in there.
So maybe I should have limped. It would have looked stronger.
Maybe should have limped, but yeah, you make you. So you, but instead you pot it, which is different from limping.
Right? So yeah, I raise pot, and then I get clicked back. Essentially, middle position raised to $4, and then the button pots it, and now there's $14.50. So I mean, I probably. You know, I could be up against two very high card hands. I mean, a low card, low flop comes. Good. I can get a stack. I decide to call. I've already invested $1.75. Okay. So the middle position calls, and I flop the nuts straight on a monotone board.
All right, so there's $44 in the flop, and the flops come down 6-4-3 diamonds. Unfortunately, you have the 7-5-4-3 and the 7-4 of spades and clubs. So you know, so diamonds are out there immediately. You do flop the nut straight. 7-5 is the nut straight, but of course, any two diamonds has you drawing dead to the full house. So you actually flop the nut straight and bottom two pair. So you know, so there's a little bit of a redraw value in your bottom two pair there. So $44 in the pot, which is you've basically got one pot size bet left in your stack, right?
Yeah, and.
You decide to check, and it actually checks through. The turn is an ace, and you decide to check again. Talk to me about that.
Well, I was planning on calling a bet. I figured that maybe I would give them another chance to bluff. I mean, the ace, the guy is repping aces really hard, so I am sort of giving him a free card now that I think about it. But also, I was kind of just hoping to get to showdown. Yeah.
Yeah, I think I'm going to stick it in here, and if I'm against diamonds, I'm against diamonds. But fact of the matter is I'm pretty sure like people will check the nut diamonds here. People will, even though this doesn't make much sense, people often check non-nut flushes, which doesn't make a lot of sense, but you see it happen. I mean, I would just think that if you're up against the flush, you're up against the flush, and that's the price you pay for playing garbage pre-flop.
All right.
Two raises.
So,
but you check and it checks through. Then the river is an eight of clubs, which is basically a complete brick because 7-5 is still the nuts. So the final board is 6-4-3, all diamonds, ace of hearts, eight of clubs. You check, the middle position player checks, and the button now shoves all in for $35, so about three quarters of the pot. You know, you're obviously didn't come this far to fold, and you've dramatically underrepresented your hand. So
yeah.
I wouldn't be surprised if you won this hand.
Well, no, the slow play got me. He checked the nuts, the river.
He checked the ace high flush all the way through?
He had aces with the ace high flush, and he checked it down.
Yeah, I mean, wow. So he picked up even the nut set redraw on the,
yeah.
on the turn. So that's pretty impressive. But of course, if he just bets the flop, he's getting it all anyway. Because here's the thing: if you play 7-5-4-3 for three races before the flop, and you flop a straight, you're probably not going to fold for when the stack to pot ratio is a one.
Yeah, I know.
All right, hand number three. Let's finish this one up.
Okay, I'm on the button, and I have the queen. The king queen 7-6 with the queen high suit the queen six of diamonds, and it folds to me, and so I raise a lot of buttons. I play like 75, maybe more.
Totally fine with raising king queen 7-6 in an unopened pot on the button.
Yeah, so I get three bet in the small blind. I raise 3x. I get three bet to $5, and I call. I flop the nuts on the 9-10 jack board with a one flush draw,
right? So it comes 10 jack 10-9. You flop the nut straight with king queen. The 10-9 is suited, so you're up against the flush draw. You do have a king of clubs blocker of sorts there, but you've got the nut straight here.
Mm-hmm. So he checks to me, and I lead to protect my hand to get value. But I don't bet much of the pot. I bet half, and he calls.
So why did you bet half the pot?
I bet because I'm looking to still get called by like ace king, aces, somebody. I want to get called by just like a lot worse hands that are like in really bad shape but don't want to fold. But okay. Yeah,
I mean, I sort of get that logic. I would tend to bet more on this kind of a board. Obviously, you know, this is a really dry, really dynamic, really wet board. So, you know, I would probably be inclined to bet more with, you know, having bet this hand. But, you know, I understand your logic as well.
Okay. So the turn is a complete brick, the six of spades. So now the board is 9, 10, jack, 6. The flush draw does not come in. Small blind checks again. I lead a little bit more than half pot this time, $13.79 into $22. And I get called again. The river is a...
So here's a spot, I think, on the turn where you definitely should bet more. Because I think aces is folding. Ace-king is folding. Basically, the only hands that... you're going to keep in the pot are things like a bare nut flush draw, and you don't really want to keep that kind of a hand in the pot. You even want to put some pressure on sets. So like if you could get say bottom set to fold, you know, second set to fold, if you can get two pair to fold, if you can get three pair to fold, that's all big wins. So I followed your logic on the flop where you were saying like a lot of the good hands that are going to chase me, that are correct to chase me, they're going to call anyway, whereas I want to keep a lot of the bad, weaker draws in. But on the turn, I don't think that's relevant anymore. There's so many hands here that I think are a threat to you that might go away if you bet more and you want to charge them the full price here. So I think your sizing here on the turn is a mistake.
Okay. So the river pairs the 9. So it's 9, 10, jack, 6, 9. And the small blind donks out for like a third of the pot, and yeah. I call.
I don't really know what to do with spots like these as well. Like I said, kind of goes back to the previous street. You gave him kind of a good price, right? So if he had something like, you know, you know a set of tens, 10-9 with a bad flush draw, all these kind of things. You know, he did 3-bet preflop, so I mean. A lot of the sort of more junky hands are out of his range, but I mean, still, like the nut flush draw is there. He might have been bluffing with the nut flush draw. He might be using the paired board to try to bluff you off the nut straight by betting the nut flush draw. I think you are correct to call because I think that happens a lot of time.
Yeah.
But I wouldn't be surprised if a lot of time he just sucked out on you.
Yeah, he sucked out with the king jack 9 played questionably. So
yeah, that's probably a little bit light. I mean, that's. I mean, I think I would have folded that hand even for your very small bet on the turn.
Yeah.
But you could have charged him more, and that would have been nice. And then, you would have ended up losing more. But, you know, in the long run, you probably make a profit if you, because, you know, he doesn't have a lot of outs, obviously.
Yeah.
How's it going in general? So how's the poker going in general? Are, you know, we've had our ups and we've had our downs. on the sort of the second to last week of our PokerStars sponsorship, how is the PokerStars doing?
It's not great. I've donated quite a bit back from my peak a while ago, and I'm working on rebuilding. It's a bit of a struggle. There's a lot of variance in Omaha, and yeah, I don't know. There's not too much to say. I should be working on my game, and I am, but it's just been kind of ugly the last month or so.
All right. Well, you do have the resources to work on the game, of course. PLO Quick Pro, our sponsor, providing us with lots of information. And there, I saw John.
This
John
is true.
Jumped in the PokerCast forum, so. You guys out there, take a cue from John. Jump in the PokerCast forum, pokercast.2plus2.com. Leave us your comments on this show thread or any other thread you like. Keep sending email to pokercast@2plus2.com. There were a couple we didn't get to this week. Adam loves doing the mailbag, as do I, of course, so we'll save him a couple. Speaking of Adam, we obviously hope he's doing well.
Yeah.
we're going to wrap the show up for this week. So please do interact with us in so many ways. Like I said, I gave you the forum. I gave you the email address. I am TChanPoker on Twitter. Ross is Pokercast Ross. Adam is Pokercast Adam. Please do send us your 140 or less thoughts as well as. And are you guys? I had a listener email me, I think actually, or tweet at me or DM me or something like that, asking if you guys were coming down to Vegas. Do you and Adam have plans? Is there a 2+2 party? A couple people have asked me that. I don't know the answer to these things.
I don't know either. Adam said earlier when we were talking before the show that he does really want to go to Vegas, but I'm not exactly sure whether that's going to happen. So it's up in the air, but...
All right, well...
You know Adam, he's very last minute. If we do end up going, it'll be like on 2 days' notice.
He is very last minute. Adam doesn't crash on couches, but of course you're welcome on mine anytime if you decide to pop down here. So hopefully I'll get to see you before I'm back in sunny Vancouver.
Yeah.
The rest of the summer. So speaking of Adam, of course, our thoughts are very much with him as we wrap up this show. I hope everything is well with his family. So I want to thank him for coming in, enjoying, hanging in there for the first hour and doing the show with me and not making me do this whole thing by myself and not putting you guys through just 2 hours of me droning on with a little backup from you, Ross. Mm-hmm. Thanks to you, Ross. Hopefully you can get home. Adam's usually your ride out to these things, so hopefully you're able to get back to where you need to be in Vancouver.
We'll see what happens. It's a pretty nice office we have here, so it wouldn't be the most...
You just sleep under a desk, George Costanza side?
There's actually a couch and a TV and everything, so... Wow. It wouldn't be terrible to be stuck here.
I know there's a coffee pot, so you just wake up in the morning, you get the coffee, and wait till the public transit can get you home, right?
Yeah.
So thanks for doing that. You pulled double duty today, trying to do co-host for the last half of the show as well as being on the ones and twos. So thanks very much for that. To Brandon Shak Harris for joining us on the break in the 1500 Omaha 88 Better. Thanks to you guys all there in PokerCast land for listening. Join us in the forums, interact with us, and until next time, until PokerCast 415, where hopefully Adam will be back. This is T-Chan signing off. See you next week, guys. Good. I want to pick up on something that you just mentioned. You know, you wanted to kind of show people that it wasn't just, hello? 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 You there?
Hello?
Hello? Yeah, I'm here.
Is anybody there?
Yeah, can you hear us? Hello?
Can you hear us? Ross, you can hear me, right?
Yeah, the call's still going.
Brandon? Brandon?
Thanks for joining us. The 2+2 PokerCast has been presented to you by the PokerStars VIP.